What's happening? Welcome to Podcast Unlock, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Episode 241 for April 14th. We, as you can tell, we held the show briefly so that we could get past the Gears of War 4 multiplayer beta preview embargo. I went and played it. We'll talk about that in a second. First, I'm Ryan McCaffrey. Destin Legarry.
Hi, everybody.
Svelte and blue, as always.
Svelte.
Very
I like that
Clark
word.
Kentish. I like
Clark
it.
Kentish.
I just saw Batman
versus glasses,
Superman.
Yeah.
This is the large version of this shirt I have. I have a medium also, so this means I need to do laundry.
You're working on it.
Yeah.
Alana Pierce, good to see you,
hey,
as
up?
Always. And the freshly food-poisoned Sean Finnegan.
You hello.
Food
you
I just had food poisoning
what
yesterday.
Did, yeah, what did you,
where'd
you get?
You go? PSA.
I was betrayed by my favorite Chipotle.
But you should know. Like,
I mean,
everyone's been getting, like,
okay,
Chipotle
what?
Is
Chipotle
death.
Is like a type of chicken?
It's a burrito place.
It's
a burrito place.
Yeah.
I was
yeah.
way off. I
it's
thought
a
it
chain.
Was a type of chicken.
It's a chain, and their chicken has been basically infected across.
They've been,
I don't know if it's their chicken. I don't know what the deal
it's their,
is
they,
with it.
It could be their
they've
lettuce.
They've been under siege so. From...
the lettuce?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The lettuce got something in it that's not supposed to be, and people were getting sick,
there's
so they
been,
had to close down for, like, a few days.
There's been some
that
crazy stuff
happened?
Going on
yeah.
with Chipotle for a little bit, but anyone who knows me knows I'm a huge advocate of Chipotle. I go there all the time. I love it. I've only gotten food poisoning from there once before.
Not
oh,
only
before.
Two times now.
Yeah. Well, in like the 10 years I've been going there, so it's you
you're
know
like,
not bad odds.
I've only had food poisoning once in my life.
Oh, it's terrible.
You're
this
like,
is the second time I've had it.
You're
I,
like
I don't think I've ever had food poisoning.
It reminds
oh,
me of
I got it at an airport in Thailand.
Oh,
boy.
It was really bad.
Oof. You remind me of the scene with Captain Picard in Star Trek Insurrection. I think it was the last one.
Haven't seen
where
that.
It's like, you know, they're sort of taking advantage of the local populace,
right.
Starfleet for their own good, and Picard's like, how many people does it take? That's what you remind me of. Like, how many times does it take for you to... Like, well, I've only been food poisoned from there now twice.
Now
but I guess I'm going to go back.
Oh, yeah.
Quick question. Did you actually go there, or did you pay somebody to bring it to your house?
No, I went there this
oh,
time.
Okay.
I
this
hit it up
time.
On the way home from... We went and saw the movie last night, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's when it was... That's when it was happening.
Oh, okay.
You guys know Rudy's? Rudy's Can't Fail Cafe?
No.
There's two of them in Oakland, and the first one... was started by one of the members of Green Day.
Huh.
Basically just like incredibly good diner. And
oh,
I didn't
nice.
Get home till like 11 last night because I'm reviewing a game on a ridiculous time frame and just ordered Postmates, Rudy's Can't Fail.
Right.
I was like, this is just going to be the best night ever. Got this delicious, like it's called like Popeye's Idaho or something. It's hash brown with a layer of
Popeye's
cheese,
chicken.
And then a layer of egg and then a layer
oh.
of spinach.
Oh, mm. oh, okay.
Delicious.
That sounds really good.
Yeah.
I thought
no
you were going to say you got food poisoning.
I did not get food poisoning.
That sounds like
yeah.
a gut bomb,
good
though.
Yeah.
That's heavy in your stomach right there.
I mean, yeah, I had a food coma afterwards, but it was very good.
Better food coma than food poisoning.
Exactly.
You've never had it before?
I don't think so.
Shark,
it
have you?
Terrible.
Do you
I,
watch?
I know, right?
Do you watch yeah. Last Week Tonight with John Oliver?
I watched like clips on the internet.
So he just did a segment like, I don't
no.
know, maybe a month ago about Chipotle.
Oh.
And all the and he actually did. They did man on the street interviews with people of like, hey, Chipotle's been, you know, running rampant with food. Would you still go there? And a bunch of people were like, yeah, that's my
yep.
favorite. You're like, that's you.
That's me, man.
You would have been one of those
big
people they interviewed.
Of Chipotle. The first time I got food poisoning there, like a week later, I was back. And I was like,
how long,
just a one-time thing.
How long before you go back this time? Two
I don't
weeks?
Know. This time was particularly bad. I missed 2 days of work. I was gone Monday and Tuesday
wow.
because of that. And I don't know, man. It'll be a while before I go back there.
You
again.
Actually, I can see it in your face. You actually
yeah.
do look thinner.
Thank you.
Well, I mean,
you look great, Sean.
Food poisoning.
You went on the food poisoning crash
when
diet.
When you have food poisoning, the reason people die is because they get dehydrated. You
yeah.
don't mm-hmm. have water, so it's like you lose all of your water weight
oh,
really,
yeah.
really quickly.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
like, it's just terrible. It's
oh,
truly terrible.
I'll spare you the details, but yeah, it's terrible, man.
Yeah.
And it's just, you
so
can't
I'd
hold
So I know if
down.
I had food poisoning at some point in my life.
Sure.
I would
it just
been
comes
like,
out of nowhere,
okay.
and you're just...
Yeah, it was when I had it, I was just vomiting.
Yeah.
And
okay.
it was like every time that I had a sip of water, I would be like, 5 minutes later, I would throw up. Like, just a
okay.
sip of water.
You can't hold anything
it's
down.
It's terrible.
Or keep anything in.
Got it. Never had food poisoning.
Problem,
I'm going to hopefully keep it
that
way.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Moving on.
Things that aren't
Games.
Vomit or diarrhea include Quantum Break,
oh,
which has
yes.
now been out for a week.
Yeah.
You guys started it yet?
Yeah, so I've played... I've
I know
now
you
played,
have. We're
going
to talk about it.
I have played the first act of the retail,
yep.
now finished version, and then I played the first two acts and watched the first two episodes back during the preview, during the spring showcase. Is that what it was?
Yes.
Yeah.
So it sounds like we probably played the same amount. I finished
yeah.
the first act. I'm just a little bit into the second.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I haven't started the second
one. And I just, I'm a little bit into Act 3. I watched the end of Act 2 live action episode last night. Yeah, what are you guys thinking of it?
So far, I really, really like it. Like, Quantum Break
it's seemingly
is,
right up your alley because, yeah. You know, you're a filmmaker, you love film, and that's this literally, blend is literally blends is. Those.
Yeah, that's literally what I was about to say. Was like, I actually really enjoy the idea of kind of, like, punctuating gameplay, like, big gameplay chunks with an awesome episode of TV. And it's so cool because the episode of TV isn't bad. Like, it's actually really
interesting. Surprisingly not bad.
Yeah, like...
It definitely has a sci-fi channel look to it, yeah. Right? Like, it's not, like, the most high-budget, expensive thing.
Totally.
But it
like,
works.
I would say, like, budget-wise, it feels way better than what Microsoft's done before with other sort of live-action versions of their stuff. Things like, you know, with Halo Nightfall and stuff.
Nightfall,
Forward Unto Dawn.
I like Forward
Unto Dawn. Let's not talk about Nightfall.
Yeah. No, but like both of them, I would say Nightfall less so than Forward Unto Dawn. But Forward Unto Dawn stands on its own 2 feet.
Yeah.
It doesn't make it great, but the production quality is pretty high.
Yeah.
Like I would say it sets the standard for web series, not if you're talking about, you know, Hollywood,
sure.
Right? It falls well short of Hollywood quality. But while this doesn't hit Hollywood quality, it does what it does pretty well in terms of Quantum Break. And I think the characters are interesting and it's cool to see the other perspective, right, of what's going on inside Monarch.
Yeah.
So I think it's really cool, and I like having that break. I talked about this a lot when I talk about Last of Us, or when I just talk about video games.
The Quantum
in general.
Break.
Sorry, yeah.
Get out.
I have this problem where storytelling in video games is ruined by gameplay, and vice versa. Like I think they don't really work together all that well.
Ludonarrative dissonance.
Yeah, exactly. And I've been wanting to do a feature on this for a long time because as a filmmaker,
Bioshock
especially in
Infinite
games,
has that so bad. Where
oh, yeah.
What you're doing,
oh, yeah.
And what the story is trying to tell you are so different.
Totally.
Like the story is like interdimensional, and then the actual game is just like you shooting people. Like
uh-huh.
They're so separate, and I found that so frustrating.
Pulling food out of trash cans,
yeah,
and
like two
and
totally
shit.
Unrelated things that are trying to tie themselves.
That's our
together.
One. We just burned it.
But yeah, like even in games that do it well, like The Last of Us, like when I'm watching those cutscenes, all I want to do is watch those cutscenes, and then the cutscene ends, and I'm like, I have to do stuff.
Yeah.
That game would have been a very good TV show.
So yeah. I completely agree with you. I actually was so I came in to this game expecting to love it because I adore Max Payne 1 and 2 and mm-hmm. I adore Alan Wake.
Which is great.
And this game's has a very different feel than any of those games. And I was a little slow to warm up to it. I started playing, I did Act 1 and I was like, I like it. It's good. But I kind of was like, on Sunday night, I was kind of, well, I'm going to watch it's HBO night. I'm going to mm-hmm. watch show. Like I wasn't super pulled back mm-hmm. to it. But then as I got into Act 2 and then through Act 2, now I'm getting, I don't know, and I can't even explain why, but I'm more into it now.
Mm-hmm.
I'm liking it more and more as I go. And I totally agree that it's the end of act live action episode is just this awesome dessert after I've just eaten my dinner.
Yeah.
And I just kick back and I'm like, sweet, now it's time to just hang back and watch the episode. And I really like it. The only thing I don't like is, because apparently the live action stuff is streamed in, the bitrate
yeah.
is horrible.
I was
like,
actually about
it
to.
It looks. The quality looks, at least on my. And I have a normal Comcast, you know, pretty decent connection, like not some cable internet connection. It doesn't look good.
Yeah, I agree with you. That's the one thing I was about to say is the viewing experience, and I wasn't sure why this was either, but now that you're telling me it's streamed in,
I mean,
that makes sense.
It have to be because it changes based on your decisions.
No, it's because the amount of video, it probably would have been 4 Blu-rays or something.
Right, because like
combined with all the game assets.
Yeah, because
so
it's different for each person. I'm pretty sure the live action show that you get.
Right, because
so
there's so many different.
It,
yeah, exactly. So there's just too much. So they. That's what I read. I'm don't 100% quote me, but
right.
I'm like 99% sure that they stream in the like you can download it, but I think it's something like. Somebody tweeted me, it's something like 120 gigs if you want to download it all.
That's crazy.
And maybe I should. Maybe I should just let it go while I'm at work all day.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, it's the quality of the live action episodes via a stream, at least in my experience, is not great.
Yeah, see, for me, it was just a little, like, the playback was a little janky at parts. Or, like, I'd see, like, a phantom frame come in, like, in between edits, like that was from a previous shot. And I'd be like, it's forgivable stuff, but, like, it kind of bugs me just a tad. That said, like, I don't know. As the episode went on, it seemed to get better. So, Minor but complaint on my end.
Is everybody's cutscene different, or are they all the same?
No, they're different.
It depends on
different.
Your choice.
They depend on your choice.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. So it's like
it's
an A or B
because it
choice.
Actually indicates. Yeah. Like, I was playing the first act. And
oh, the little
this
yellow
one.
Bug up in the...
Yeah, so yeah. There's a couple, right? Like, there's one that says, like, okay, so in the gameplay, you can find these clues that actually trigger scenes in the TV show.
Yes.
And mm-hmm. it's like, this icon will appear when you're seeing, what is it, a quantum ripple?
Mm-hmm. Something
which is
like that.
Like,
yeah.
A particular scene or a particular shot will not be in that episode if you didn't find that thing in the gameplay, which is actually real cool. And you can see that because it actually indicates it with an icon.
Interesting.
Yeah. So far, they haven't been like anything like super prominent in mine. Like, again, I'd only played in the retail version of the first act, but it was just a very minor scene of two guys saying something about, like, in a line of dialogue, something that I had found in the game.
Oh, okay.
Which wouldn't have been there otherwise, which I think was super cool.
My whole
just
thing,
the idea that they're connected, you know?
My whole thing about games like this is, like, before it comes out, I've had to play an hour and a half of it three times, and I have to play through that hour and a half to get to the new stuff again. So I'm just kind of like, I've already seen, like, the first hour of the game.
Yeah.
I don't want to play for the fourth time, so there's always that bar I have to get over. And that's the only reason I haven't picked it up.
Woe is me,
one.
Right, Destin?
Well, yeah,
no,
it's part of gameplay capture.
It's a,
no, totally.
It's
so.
A yeah. unfortunate part of our job,
yeah.
if you want to call it
yeah.
that. Yeah, and also, I liked I guess you guys haven't seen the second live-action episode yet.
No.
I
liked,
saw it during the preview, yeah.
I liked it a lot better than the first episode.
Yeah,
I thought it was much better than...
Well, oddly...
Not to say the first episode was bad, but I just liked episode two better.
I agree, and like... I actually like Act 2 in the gameplay better, too. Like, to me, everything that I've played so far just ramps up, you
yeah.
know? Like, the first act of gameplay is very much, like, establishing who the characters are and, like, what you're capable of and
mm-hmm.
kind of setting the stage, and then everything just goes, like goes 0 to 60 real fast right after that. Super cool.
I love hearing everybody else's enthusiasm for the game because it's like, oh, man, like, I have to check this out.
I think it's cool, man.
You know?
Like, I'm a huge advocate, especially nowadays in all of entertainment, not just video games, of new IP and new ideas. And even if a game or a movie falls short of an original vision, I appreciate it for having an original vision. And I think that this game
nails it.
I couldn't agree
aside
more.
Aside from the TV tie-in, what do you think is original about it?
Just like the storytelling, man. Like, I love time travel stuff. Like, I think the performances are good. I love the idea of,
I don't think
like,
the gameplay is very original. I mean, I think it's good. But I don't think it's unique.
I mean, it's very much a halfway. That's, it's
a
like a it's like a weird amalgamation of Max Payne and Alan Wake. Really, it's like it's
and
not as fast.
Or prototype.
Yeah, it's not
as
fast and smooth as Max Payne. You know, it's got it's a little slower than that. But with you know the time power stuff, yeah, it's definitely not the most original thing gameplay wise. But it executes pretty well.
Yeah, the storytelling is definitely.
I really
haven't
really seen
the powers
I also really
are
haven't
unique,
seen
right?
a game.
Yeah, they
yeah
are,
where it's
yeah.
like you can. I don't know, the idea that you can, like, so there's time travel games and then there's time manipulation games. This one's kind of both.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
it uses the logic of the time travel mechanics to manipulate the gameplay, right? That, I think, is pretty cool. I haven't seen a game that really does that.
I mean, it definitely does it better than something like Life is Strange or whatever, but it's...
I haven't played it, so...
Don't.
Yeah.
I hate it.
That's weird. I thought a lot of people...
Final review.
A lot of people
no,
do like
it's
it.
It's divisive.
They like episodes 1, 2, and 3, and then after that
episodic.
I heard it falls apart.
It's all terrible.
Like later.
It's just
anyway.
All complete trash. Yeah, it definitely uses the time control mechanics in the actual combat in a smart way, though it's totally illogical. It's like, how is this shield capturing all of these bullets and then killing all of these men through time? Like, I have no idea how that's happening, but it doesn't
time
really matter.
Time travel rarely makes sense.
Well, and I like
it.
I saw
Back to the Future.
One of the loading screens had a like quantum fact.
Mm-hmm.
Which I hadn't even thought about. So it's like, oh, so within the context of the Quantum Break universe, you can only go back in time as far as the time machine was built,
yeah.
which in the narrative, I don't know if
I
it's
guess
a spoiler.
That makes sense.
Because it's like, oh, because you're walking in and
it's
going like counterclockwise. So if you go back to the Stone Age, there's nothing to walk out of.
Yeah.
Huh.
But though I will say on the gameplay front, the one thing I am missing. I like all the time powers. I really want to be able to dive like Max
totally,
Payne.
Yeah.
I super want to dive and like hit dudes with the you know the stop, the freeze, and then blast
Rockstar
them.
Rockstar has that trademarked.
Remedy invented it.
Like, I mean, yeah, Rockstar owned
it. Remedy literally invented it with Max Payne.
Bullet time is a thing that they own, even though.
Well, they can call it. They can call it Joyce time.
Maybe if they made it a different name, they'd still be allowed.
Jack time.
I feel like they
get jacked. The jack button. Jacking off. Wait. Different thing. Different thing.
That's a VR thing.
That's. Oh man, but yeah, I'm liking the game more as I get into it, and I'm glad to hear you guys. I just appreciate that it's legitimately trying a new way of storytelling.
It definitely
in games.
Is. Yeah, I also think it's gorgeous. Mm-hmm. It's a very good looking game.
Yeah, agreed, yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. Other stuff that's going on. Again, just played Gears of War 4. So Rod Ferguson, as you probably could tell from the title of the episode this week, the studio head at the Coalition, aka the man heading up Gears of War for now until the end of time. He stopped by a few days ago. We've got that recorded. That's going to be after the news and marketplace report, so before Unlock Block. So we've got about a 20 or 30 minute interview with him. Stay tuned for that. And as for Gears, so I think I'm the only one that's played it so far, right? Because the actual beta starts next week.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, you can read all my stuff on IGN. I've got impressions, but the short version, which I encourage you to go watch the video, check it out, see it in action.
We're going to have some gameplay.
Oh, yeah. It's up now. I mean, mm-hmm. as people hear or see this, it's up. But, yeah, it's very much trying to just nail Gears of War. There's not a lot new going on, for better or for worse.
I'm
but
so fine with that.
Take a look for yourself. Please read my impressions and listen for the interview with Rod later in the show.
I was pretty hesitant to get excited about Gears of War 4, but they finally did something interesting. They tied Marcus Fenix to the new character in
that
trailer.
Oh, you're talking about the trailer. Yeah, the story trailer.
And I'm like, okay, a reason to care about the character. That's all I ever wanted. I'm very happy.
JD into that tree.
It's a little cheesy.
I'm pretty sure he's doing a Dom's knife.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Okay, that's cool.
The feels.
Yeah. Yeah.
So sad. But I didn't play Judgment. But I love Gears 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah.
One of the most expensive collectibles that I own is a $600 replica snub pistol that I just...
Good. It's not even the most interesting weapon in the game.
Well, it's basically all they had. So it was the one
Lancer.
That was available to me. They did
what
have
can
Lancer,
I spend $600 on? That's Gears
snub
of War
pistol.
Right now.
Well, there's also
we
a
have this pistol.
And a retro Lancer and the original Lancer as well. But they all sold out really fast. The Talk Bow looks very cool. I love Gears of War, but I didn't play Judgment, so I feel like this is like the perfect amount of time to effectively reboot something, which I'm imagining this is going to be
in a
kind
manner
of
speaking,
like that.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, I didn't want to play Judgment because after 3, I was like, I don't need any more Gears of War. I almost feel like I've overconsumed it. Like, I don't want to ruin the franchise by playing too much of it. So now that we've had like a nice amount of time to wait, I'm super excited about Gears 4. I haven't played Gears in forever. It's like, I just feel like it's perfect timing.
Mm-hmm. You didn't dabble with the Ultimate Edition from last fall?
Yeah, I did a little, but not, you know, really heavily. So
yeah, I played like the first couple hours of the campaign again, and I was just like, yep, this totally holds up.
Yeah.
I love it.
Gears
of
War 1 is such a good game.
It's really good.
Weird personal note, I really don't like how they changed the Hammer of Dawn. Like, they just changed the sounds and how it works. And I'm just like,
Hammer
why
Dawn,
did you
the one
change
that, like,
it?
Shoots from the saddle.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
You have to, like,
I'm like,
how did they, hold it for
they
a
changed
bit.
The sound effects. It goes like beep, beep. And then the sounds like this really muted nuke sound. Before it was like very
harsh.
It
didn't need changing.
Yeah. Like a fire. How did
they didn't change
the
mechanics,
controls?
I guess. It just feels different. Like, I was playing online and I grabbed the hammer. I'm like, oh yeah, I'm going to nuke somebody. And then it's like.
Yeah,
I'm like, that doesn't make you
feel
powerful.
Hey, you left your vacuum cleaner on.
Yeah.
The whole thing of the Hammer of Dawn existing and like what it did and what it was created for is just so freaking cool. Like,
yeah.
Gears of War was so good.
Hammer Dawn and what was it? The Boom Shot.
Boom Shot's really good.
Yeah, those are my
that's
two favorite
four.
Weapons.
The Boom Shot. Yeah. It's the Boom Shot, the crossbow with the.
That's
like
the Torque Bow.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Again, I only ever played the first Gears.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about.
Yeah, I know.
Play
yeah.
three. Three is the best.
Is that on
360?
Three
is really good.
Oh, God.
Man.
Here we go again.
Oh my God.
So you said three is the best. You think two is the best. Yeah. Mitch thinks Judgment's the best.
Mitch is.
Marty thinks two.
Not
is the
here
best.
Anymore. It's a defender.
Two is. The dumbest.
Such a good game.
I don't want to go.
I also really liked.
We've had this conversation so many times.
we're in a quantum break time loop right now. All right, we'll come right back. We got some interesting news going on this week, and then the interview with Rod Ferguson right after this. All right, news time. Enough of your Destiny chatter, you
I
guys.
Agree.
Save
Enough
it for the
it.
Destiny show.
Nobody
fires chat, chat right here on IGN, hosted by Destin and me.
First up this week, this one came out of nowhere for me. I don't know about you guys.
Yeah.
Because we remember a couple months ago, something like that, we heard, oh, Leslie Benzies, the like main creative director person at Rockstar North on the entire Grand Theft Auto series. Turns out he had been on a sabbatical and then decided to just retire. Like, okay, well, cool. He cashed out.
Yeah, we talked about this.
Yeah, clearly made a ton of money, and that was it. Well, this week, news breaking that he has... It is a he, by the way. He is suing Rockstar Games for $150 million, alleging unpaid royalties and that he was not allowed to come back to work following his sabbatical, which I believe was something like 7 months, something like that.
So I read that it was from September 2014. So
right after they shipped the...
Right.
Well, actually, no, that's a year later.
But until to now, like, that's a long time. Like, that's
well,
not,
no, not
half.
Till now. The sabbatical wasn't until now, though. I mean, this lawsuit broke now. But,
right.
So here's...
Sounds like they tried to take some money from him.
We only have... we have a statement from both sides. So I'm just going to read you the statements. Because I think... You know, I don't even want to begin to speculate on this because without letting the court proceedings go, because I think either subconsciously and even consciously for some people, they inherently think, oh, you know, the little guy got wrong, the big company's evil. We don't know. Like, Leslie Benzies could be a huge tool who is impossible to work with for all we know. I mean, the guy's, you know, we don't know. The guy's been there forever. But here is Leslie Benzies' attorney's statement. While on sabbatical, Mr. Benzies discovered numerous deceptions on the part of Take-Two, Rockstar, Rockstar North, Sam Houser, and Dan Houser, who sought to force him out of the company and terminate his portion of royalty payments based on arbitrary actions by the company's Royalty Allocation Committee, a committee that may or may not have actually ever met. Okay, so that is the allegation there. Rockstar issued a statement to us when we followed up. And here is Rockstar's statement. Leslie Benzies was a valued employee of our company for many years. Sadly, the events that culminated in his resignation ultimately stem from his significant performance and conduct issues. Despite our repeated efforts to address and resolve these issues amicably both before and after his departure, Leslie has chosen to take this route in an attempt to set aside contract terms to which he previously agreed on multiple occasions. His claims are entirely without merit and in many instances downright bizarre, and we are very confident this matter will be resolved in our favor. A core ethos since Rockstar's inception has been the concept of the team. It is deeply disappointing and simply wrong for Leslie to attempt to take personal credit for what has always been the tremendous efforts of the entire Rockstar team, who remain hard at work on delivering the most immersive and engaging entertainment experiences we can.
I just have
for
to say,
our fans.
This is so juicy.
It really
this
is.
This is so drama.
Yeah.
There is a lot here.
It really makes me think, have you guys watched Mad Men?
Uh-huh.
Remember when Don goes on sabbatical for a while because he gets like forced out of the company and he's gone for like a year and he's just trying to keep tabs on what's going on.
And then he comes back and makes the best commercial of all time and makes them billions of dollars.
He's keeping tabs on the company using like moles on the inside trying to figure out like what's going on and stuff. Like, this is what this reminds me of, you know, like he's out on the out, like to everyone else in the world, like he's just on sabbatical, right? But like, you know, there's all this behind the scenes drama. That's what, like, what I'm imagining in my head here.
Mm-hmm. Also, I want to do a dramatic reenactment.
Yeah, $150 million.
That's a huge amount of money.
Well, but you got to remember, we talked about this when he went on sabbatical originally. He had to be making...
Had to be. We're speculating.
An impressive salary before he left. And plus all the insane bonuses that they probably got from each GTA, which, you know, each has sold more than the last, culminating in GTA 5, I think... What is it, over 50 million, I think, was the last? I mean, the bonuses. So the guy's clearly making good. So $150 million dollars is a ton of money. But when you consider if they are, in fact, withholding royalties, I totally believe that there'd be $150 million in Grand Theft Auto royalties because of how well that series has sold over the years. Sure.
Definitely. And maybe he's suing because he didn't get all this money that you're thinking he might have. And he's like, hey, I helped make the Grand Theft Auto series.
Not even just, helped make it, but led it.
And I want my cut. You know, and his cut is $150 million, which is why he's suing for that.
But again, we also don't know, for all we know, because it definitely, Grand Theft Auto 5 was made, I mean, the core Rockstar North team is hundreds of people, but then they also get, like, every other Rockstar studio involved in, whether it's testing or whether it's some gameplay system, they are, like, 1,000-person efforts. So Rockstar is certainly not wrong to say it's a team.
Yeah,
but at the same time, they're gonna settle. No, I mean, at this, I totally get it. Like, the team is super important. All of these entertainment franchises, both in movies and games, are huge collaborative efforts. But the creative director and the producers are probably a little bit more important than like a coder.
Of course,
well, in the grand scheme of things, I guess. But at the same time, like, if he signed a contract or something, which is basically what Rockstar's statement said,
signed multiple contracts that basically said the same thing.
Yeah.
I mean, and
he's open for a settlement. I bet. $150 million. Maybe if I get half that, fine. You know.
But
definitely
for me,
$75 million.
Yeah. Still good.
Yeah.
Like he can Jason West it and just go off into the sunset with millions of dollars and live on a beach for the rest of his life. Mm. But for me, however this turns out in the courts, I'm honestly just sad. As a gamer, I'm sad because this is a guy who has been a key part of some of my favorite games ever. I mean, Grand Theft Auto 3 is a top probably 5 game of all time for me. I mean, when I first played that, it transformed me.
Yeah.
And then I think GTA 5 is legitimately one of the greatest video games ever made.
Yeah.
For sure.
I really truly do.
Fantastic.
And so to me, I'm just sad that we're not going to have him he won't be working on GTA anymore.
Mom and Dad are fighting.
Pretty much.
Going back, when 3 launched, it took me a while to wrap my head around it. I'm like, there's this whole world that you can explore, basically, like New York, basically, right?
Yeah.
And it's just like, I can do anything.
Pretty much.
Like anything I want to. And it was hard to kind of.
And you could do the missions in any number of ways.
I would leave my game running and play the radio stations because there was such funny commentary on it. I'm just like, this is just so crazy that I'm experiencing this this way.
All the hidden jumps, if you did like 50, what do you do? Like 50 of the police. Mm-hmm. Vigilante missions. You just steal a cop car and start answering the calls. Do enough of those, then you get like a permanent armor at your base, your hideout.
That
game was transformative.
I was
absolutely
really young when I played it, but I really distinctly remember this one mission where there's like this like courtyard and there's all these white vans that I think you have to put bombs in them, and then you had to like run away before they exploded or before everyone killed you. And I know that I just spent like forever trying to do that. And when I finally got it done, I was like, could die happy now. And I would have been maybe 12 when I played it. Like, I was very young when I started playing GTA, but that game was, absolutely incredible. Yeah. I wish that I had to play Vice City, though. It bugged out on me.
Oh.
Mm. Oh, Vice City bugged out on you?
Yeah, because I bought the trilogy with the original Xbox.
Oh, yeah.
So it was like, it came with GTA 3, Vice City, and San Andreas. And Vice City, I just kept falling through the floor.
Oh, man. That sucks.
Yeah.
But, it's going to be very interesting to see.
This is really interesting. I hate how interested I am.
Yeah. It's very drama heavy. Yeah.
Yeah, it'll just be interesting to see what Grand Theft Auto 6 inevitably looks like without him. Like if there's will there be a noticeable change in direction in some capacity, whether it's a gameplay change or a tonal change. Mm-hmm. You know, it'll be very fascinating to see what the next game looks like.
Hopefully there's not a dramatic impact on 6. This isn't a franchise I want to see go through turmoil.
Absolutely not. Right? Like, after you've gone through this many iterations of the game, with or without your creative lead, like, you think you have a pretty good idea have to be.
Well, it's not like the same thing every time, though. Like, look at what 5 does with the character swapping and everything. They make dramatic innovations from game to game.
But here's the thing. I talk a lot about, I think I've said this before, but it's very rare in the games business that a core team, talking about the leads, the main people, they stay together for an extended amount of time. Like, Rare had that for many years. Bungie had that for a while, but like the Bungie you know now, and it's this is not I'm not ripping on them, but the Bungie now is very, very different than the Halo Bungie. It's not the same people. There's Jason Jones and there's one, but it's mostly a different team. But mm-hmm. the Grand Theft Auto team, that with the Housers and Leslie Benzies and Aaron, the art director. I can't remember the art director's name, but it had been the same core team pretty much since 3. Mm-hmm. You're talking like 10, 15 years, which is virtually unheard of. And you know, when you get a talented group of people, that's like keeping the Michael Jordan era Chicago Bulls together to win 6 championships. I mean, that's exactly, whereas most teams end up guys leave as free agents, they get traded, and things get disbanded, and you know, it you can't keep that group together. They kept that group together. So it's sad that group, at least a big piece of them, is now no longer there.
It's also scary to think about, like, the idea that maybe that group is why each GTA has sold more or has gotten better. Like, I didn't like 4 that much, but I think 5 is incredible. Mm. Like, it's scary that if we lost that team, then we would lose GTA. But at the same time, I don't know if Rockstar has ever made a bad game. Like
Rockstar North.
Rockstar
specifically
North.
Specifically Rockstar North.
Game.
Let's specify.
Well, they certainly haven't, because their credited games... I'm trying to remember if Manhunt wasn't that good. And
was that North?
I don't remember if it was credited to them. I'll have to look it up.
Wasn't there a tennis game?
That wasn't North.
That wasn't North.
But it was also good.
Was it?
It was good.
Really?
Table tennis.
It was literally
good,
made
as a
test bed for the Rage engine, which would go on to power GTA 4 and all their other stuff. And they commercialized it and released it as a game.
GTA 4's controls and like narrative and everything was kind of clunky, but
yeah, I didn't like GTA 4 so much.
But its achievement was its visual fidelity.
Yeah,
well, like basically,
the density of that world was incredible.
Oh, man.
I
remember
the in-game internet, which was hilarious.
Yeah, I remember like you would walk down a street and it would start raining and people would actually pull out their umbrellas.
Ew,
for whatever reason, I was like, whoa, these people are alive. Manhunt
is credited
and they have
to
money.
Rockstar North, by the way.
Well, when Manhunt came out, because it was edgy, I thought it was cool, but I don't know what I actually thought of it as an game.
Also, Manhunt apparently
the
best gay dating app to chat with and meet guys worldwide. That's the other. That's the more modern version of Manhunt, according to the Google search results.
Yeah.
So, just FYI, if you're
hunting for men, then there you go. Sponsored by Manhunt.
You know, that's Podcast Unlocked, brought to you by Manhunt. So, wow, this table is not.
Level.
Look at that. There you go. Learned something new today. So anyway, very, very fascinating drama afoot at Rockstar Games. We will probably not hear anything else about this until it's resolved. Be curious to see how it resolves. I agree with you. I think, Destin, I think it'll be a settlement, almost certainly. That's just unless they're just so angry at each other that either or both of them decides, nope. I'm sticking this out. I'm gonna take this to the death.
Well, that'd probably be Leslie. He's probably pissed.
But you never. Well, Rockstar could be like, "F this guy." He's
that's their reaction.
We don't know.
Yeah.
There's no better way to calm some nerves than a nice $60 or $70 million settlement. So.
Yeah,
sure,
we're good, right?
Fine.
You got $70 million.
It did make $1 billion in like a day.
Yeah,
remember?
In the grand scheme of things, for how profitable GTA has been, that's not really that much money.
I can't really think of any like slight against me that wouldn't be immediately forgotten with
by $70 million.
Yeah,
but like, no, it's fine.
Remember,
do you
though,
take $60 million today in exchange for like $2 billion lifetime?
If I'm a game dev, yes.
Yeah.
But remember, Sean, you got try to put yourself in Leslie's shoes though, because seemingly in his mind,
I don't think
it's
about the money.
No,
if you were a game developer. And you had worked on this huge thing, and you believe that you have a contract that entitles you to $150 million, and they go, no, and then you sue them, and then they're like, okay, well, we'll settle with you for 60.
Sure.
That's not going to seem so great. Because I'm owed $150.
But at the same time, like, in my mind, and I do not know the legal proceedings at all, but, like, that should be a pretty clear-cut case whether or not you deserve it or not, right? Mm-hmm. Like, if you sign the contract.
So. But yeah. you never know, man.
Right? Yeah, no, you're totally right. You don't know.
Yeah.
But you're right. I mean, here's the thing. I don't know. For a game dev, it feels like there is so few games make that much money just total in general. If you could settle for $60 or $70 million for just you personally, I don't know.
Yeah, I think it's that he's mad.
It's easy to say sitting here.
Yeah. Sure.
He's in New York. He can buy a house in the city if he wants.
Well, Rockstar North is in Edinburgh, Scotland.
Go to New York, Destin. There are no houses there.
Well, you could buy something for $20 million.
He could buy
the
sweet apartment in the Upper West Side.
He could live in New York City for 10 months.
All right. Yeah.
What other game can I make? All right. Anyway, Titanfall 2. On to less dramatic, happier news. Where are my Titanfall people at?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Still love that game. It shipped a little. You know, not a lot of meat on the bones. Mm. It added that meat onto the bones as time went on, but unfortunately by then, a lot of the community had moved on.
Yeah, so it just ended up dispersing people more than anything.
Yeah. But we knew Titanfall 2 was coming. We had since found out that, as we speculated and hoped and prayed to the gaming gods, that it would have a single-player campaign. It does. We got our first official, like, formal official acknowledgement of it. Did you guys see the little teaser trailer?
Yes. Yeah. It was great.
So and what did it do for you, Destin?
Got me excited. I'm definitely excited about the game. Really liked the tease at the end about the new weapon mechanics. I think I heard a dinosaur at one point.
You heard the mech stomping around.
I'm going to go. I'm hoping dinosaurs.
Because I had the same.
Dinosaurs versus
I had the same thought at first, too. I'm like, is that a dinosaur? Oh.
Yeah.
And then the leg stomps in. you're referring.
I hope you fight a dinosaur in the story. Please.
That would
please
be great.
Make this happen.
Or a mech dinosaur.
Oh my god!
Mechasaur.
Like Vanquish? I swear that's a thing in Vanquish.
Probably.
Like the Dinobots?
I didn't even think of mech dinosaur. Now I'm really excited.
Ninja Gaiden has those. It's like Ninja Gaiden 3 has that one giant T-Rex that's also a mech.
Yep.
Incredible.
More of
that. Genius.
You're
also swords.
weapon, you're of course referring Shark to.
The sword.
The sword.
Mm-hmm.
How great is that?
Dude, the sword is... I mean, here's the thing. If games have told you anything, it's that swords are awesome. Like,
the
Destiny...
sword in Destiny? That's what I was going to say.
When Destiny added swords, everyone was like, sword! Yeah. It's like, it's so
it's
cool,
like all guns, then a sword, and everybody's like, what?
A sword, yeah.
The end of one of the Arkham games has Batman with a sword. Yeah. I was just like, this is heaven. Like, this is all I wanted.
Halo
2,
when you were like, there's a sword in Halo 2?
Yeah.
Like, at the Covenant sword?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, like...
It's still the thing I'm best with in multiplayer.
Yeah,
like,
dude,
I'm unstoppable with a sword.
Halo 1 was like, they have swords. I want that. Oh, I can't get it. Halo 2's like,
I don't know,
here
like,
you go. Have fun.
I feel like it's something that goes like, people never remember it, but then they always, like, they totally should, is that in any shooter, the best thing you can do to, like, up the ante in the sequel is add melee weapons, like swords.
Yeah, you're so right.
Yeah. Like, any shooter.
Did they do that with Left 4 Dead 2? I know that was
robot dinosaurs.
Also, dinosaurs.
Yes.
There was a sword in, I don't know about one, but I for sure one of the Left 4 Deads had a sword.
It had
in
a katana, but I just don't know if it was in the first one as well.
I think it was in two. I think first one
was. It was in two, but I don't know if it was in both.
It's a little different, though, because like Left 4 Dead already had like melee weapons, like even in the verse iteration.
Yeah, but still the sword, though.
Yeah,
we
still
a sword. Yeah. So now we need a gun that shoots swords.
Sword launcher. That sounds like something out of Sunset Overdrive.
Or a sword that shoots guns.
Yeah.
Huh?
That's fine.
How does that even work?
Yeah, that's
wait
a
already
second.
A thing.
That already exists. So, yeah, to me, this is how you do a teaser trailer, right? Like, where you don't really say anything, but you say one cool thing. You, like, leave, like, they're like, okay, there's the pod. That's a Titan. That's a. And then, okay, here's the Titan.
You sound like the guy who made the trailer after watching it for the 80th time. There's the Titan.
Yeah.
And then he drops the sword.
Goodness.
Everybody else is like, what?
Dude, that's how it is when you make something. I just had to do the Star Wars teaser trailer for April Fool's. I watched that thing like 1,000 times. And then by the end, I'm like, is this even cool anymore?
Yeah.
Is this cool or is it like, am I just... bored. Yeah. It's hard
when
to tell.
When you think about editing a video, the amount of times you actually have to watch that video. It'd be a 10-minute video, but if you to get it to 10 minutes, it's like an hour of stuff that you have to cut into 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Watch over and over and
What's that like?
Or like, there's so many iterations that we went through. People were like, what changes did you make? And I was like, dude, I don't know. At some point, there was like... this whole section wasn't here. Like, it's crazy.
So the full reveal for the game was dated at the end of the teaser for June 12th, which is when EA Play press conference thing is at E3. So expect to see Vince Zampella come out on stage and probably demo Titanfall 2, which I'm so happy about.
Yeah, I'm stoked. We talked about it before, but like, while Titanfall didn't really like live up to the huge hype that everyone had for it, like, it definitely set a really good foundation for a franchise.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's the exact same way that I feel about Watch Dogs, where I was like, they played this safe. It'll be better next time. Like, I knew the sequel would be better. The way that I played most of Titanfall was when I was listening to lectures at university, and I would just listen to the game like really low volume and the lectures really high, like over the internet. So Titanfall was like my studying companion.
You were in college when that game came out?
Yeah.
We were all right here.
I was in university last year.
Oh, my God.
Sorry. Right.
Yeah, we're old, Sean. Just newsflash.
No, you're old. I'm not that old yet.
Sorry. You got
how old are you?
Little gray.
29.
Oh, the last year.
I didn't know you were
before
29.
It all.
Really? How old did you think I was?
I don't know. 26.
Oh, that's how old he was when I met him.
Wow. That's good though. Most people think I'm older than I am.
Huh.
We got a couple grays in there.
That's the thing. It's not, the age. Not, like,
yeah, it's not doing you
any. Asian
my
dude
entire
in
hair is gray.
But you dyed
what
it.
What is your point?
That was by choice.
Yeah.
I didn't choose to have gray hair in my beard.
Yeah, I've got a couple that have. I'm like, what the hell? I'm only 35.
But it's
what's
less noticeable on you because your hair's lighter. Like, mine's super dark. So you can spot it. But I don't actually mind the gray hair. I'm just glad I'm not going bald.
I think it looks cool. That's why I dyed mine gray.
That's true. You got to look at the positives. Yeah. You got the full head of hair.
Well, as soon as I get, like, my, you know, people have told me that, you know, gray hair makes guys look distinguished. Unless you're like Silver Fox. That's a little too much.
Got a little salt and pepper. You're okay.
Yeah, it's going salt and pepper. So I figure as soon as I turn 30, I'll just stop wearing contacts and wear glasses and all of a sudden be 40
years
old.
You're a professor,
yeah.
Now,
you're going to look like a Ransky as soon as you turn 30.
Does your family history indicate that full head of hair is safe, or are you at risk?
Yeah, my grandfather didn't start going bald until he was like 80.
Yeah.
And my dad never made it to that age, but he also had a full head of hair throughout his whole life. So all indications are good.
How about you, Destin? Yeah.
I should be bald already.
Really? So you're defying the odds right now?
Yeah. It's your mom's side and my grandfather side.
Mother's father, right, is what they always say. Look at your maternal grandfather.
Yeah, what? And as long as I knew my Grandpa Macedon, he was bald. Huh. So I guess I got my Grandpa Roy's genes. He had full head of hair his whole life.
Nice.
So maybe they just canceled each other out, you know?
What about you, Alana? Balding?
I actually don't know if this is a thing do women go bald?
They can.
Yeah, I mean, they definitely can.
I think
you would have known.
I think it's more often, though, that it's just, like, thin.
Hair loss.
Yeah.
Oh, no, that happens to me all the time because I bleach my hair so much, so.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, well.
Well, it's weird because, like, people are always saying that, like, isn't hair just dead cells anyway? Is that right? Or is that skin?
Welcome to Biology Unlocked.
Yeah.
That's your fingernails.
Never mind.
Anyway.
Okay.
The thing that really trips me out to keep talking about hair is, you know what? Whenever you shower, I'm pretty sure this happens to everyone, you will, like, if you wash your hair will come out.
Yeah, always.
You will lose hair.
Yeah. Yeah.
How are we not all bald by now? Because it doesn't grow as fast as we lose it. You lose, like, five hairs every time you shower?
That's not a lot.
It doesn't grow
back. Thousands of them.
It takes years to grow hair, though. Like, statistically, I don't understand how we have hair. Like, it doesn't make sense.
Someone needs to add,
how do I still
like...
have long hair?
So that sword in Titanfall.
Welcome to, welcome to Follicles Unlocked. Yeah, thankfully, I should be safe. My maternal grandfather... actually rode a Harley and had a ponytail. He had long hair into his 80s.
Yeah. Where's your ponytail?
My barber always, and thank God, because I'm stuck with this face. So if like I can at least have the full head of hair.
But you have a radio voice.
Right. As long as you don't see me. But my wife has to look at me. You know, anybody I socially interact with has to look at me. So maybe I'll start doing if I ever lose my hair, maybe I'll do the Kylo Ren thing. I'll just the hood and the mask.
Well,
How are you today?
Your Kylo Ren sounds a little like Beavis. You're Beavis.
How are you today, Destin? Welcome to Podcast Unlocked. I'm Butthead.
Oh, that's really good.
My time codes are all thrown off now. I don't even know
balding
what to do.
Part.
Yeah, I don't know what
Titanfall
happened.
Titanfall briefly.
That one out. Yeah, around 40 we talk about. Right.
All right.
Moving on.
Moving on.
Oh,
so
man.
Here's more shenanigans out of the UK. First the Rockstar lawsuit, and now this. A rumor from UK gaming website MCV suggests that Fable Legends may not be dead after all. Listen to this. According to MCV, sources at Lionhead say, quote, discussions are ongoing about saving the free-to-play RPG. MCV says the staff at Lionhead are, quote, being surveyed as to whether they would like to continue working on the game in place of the redundancy package, aka a severance package, they have been offered. One source says the new offer is because of a proposal from some members of Lionhead to take Legends and continue development as an indie studio. What do you guys make of this? Because I certainly have an opinion, but I want to hear what you guys have to say first.
That game has to be really close to being done, is one point. Like, that's what I keep thinking is just release it, but surely it's more complicated than that. But on the other hand, I would prefer if they just didn't and made something else instead rather than laying everyone off.
Destin?
Just release the product that you had in beta for like weeks. Like people were playing it. Just release that and just put a disclaimer up front like, hey, this is what we got.
Make it really cheap.
Enjoy.
Well, it was free. It was a free to play game. Sorry.
Oh, right. It was free.
This is kind of just where we ended.
It's free.
Yeah.
Sean, what do you think?
I don't know. I mean, I think it's a bummer. I just think like, even if that game wasn't shaping up, there were people who were excited to play it. And to hear that it's like dead and then not dead, like, I don't know. It kind of sucks to be kind of in limbo if you're one of those fans. So, I mean, like,
I have an idea.
If you could, it would
Does
be cool.
Does anyone know a fan
it.
Of that game?
I don't know. I'm just saying, like, you have
people
to imagine
listen to
there's
show
some out
tweet
there.
At me a lot.
People really like it.
Because I'm not a big fan of it. But they're like, hey, I loved it. Like, you're crazy.
Huh. So, for me, I.
Wait,
I think,
wait. I have a
ahead,
thought before
ahead.
You do yours, because I think yours is really good. But release the game. Charge $4.99 for it and be like, if enough people buy this, we'll save Lionhead.
That's holding a studio hostage.
Well, like,
so buy
evil,
this game
Destin.
Or all of these
like,
people lose
that's
their
what
jobs.
Kickstarter is. Fine, start a Kickstarter for it.
That's
everybody
so
do $4.99
or we're going to kill the hostage.
Yeah.
I love you, but that is a terrible idea.
That's so horrible.
So, for me, Microsoft has this.
Then
is,
it's just gone.
This whole situation, Microsoft's got it backwards. We need to save the studio, kill the game, not the other way around.
How does killing the game save the studio, though?
Well, if it's either or.
If they say, hey, we're releasing this game, and if it sells this well, we'll be able to
save
Lionhead.
Well, I'm saying if they want to put some money back in and start something else, don't, like, okay, let this game go. Like, just forget about it. It's over. Start something else.
Let it die.
Let it go. So, because here's my take on this. I mean, everybody knows how I feel about this game, which is it's a decent game, but it has always sat wrong with me because it's got the Fable name on it and it doesn't do anything.
It's basically a lie.
It doesn't do anything that Fable's good at, and that Fable and it doesn't do anything that makes Fable special and makes Fable Fable.
It's basically a lie.
It is.
But, I mean, why do you think Microsoft canceled it? Because I, in my opinion, and I don't, again, I've gotten in trouble for talking about this game before, but I just think this game would be forgotten about in a week. That's my honest, like, sorry, here it is, take on it. Because all the way back to when this was announced at I was there, Gamescom 2013.
Me too.
We were there. You were there.
Yep.
Well, you were they in showed it.
You were
you were
on
in
that
diapers.
Side of the world.
I was actually at Gamescom 2013 as well. Thank you.
Oh, snap.
Yeah. I
but
was still a journalist while I was studying.
They showed it behind closed doors. I mean, from moment one, every bit of this is a game that in the community and in the media has been extremely divisive. There's been a lot of wait, huh? Like, wait, is this? Yeah. Has there? So answer me honestly. Do you guys? Has there ever been any significant buzz on this game? I'm talking like where there is sort of that wave of enthusiasm.
No, definitely not.
For me, looking at statistics on videos I published, the stuff we did from Gamescom 2013, it was DOA.
It's not even
nobody was interested.
It's not even just like video views and article views, but the only time anyone was ever talking about it was in a negative light, which is like,
skeptical light, right? Yeah. Like, because it's only ever been met with skepticism, confusion, lukewarm hands-on reports from people like me, disappointment that this is a Fable game. So, like, the studio is worth saving. There are clearly talented people there. I think it is the right move to just not have this game come out. Mm-hmm. But I just wish that.
But why? When it was so close to being done, why not just release it?
Because then whatever.
They have to support it with servers?
Well, then you have. Yeah. Maybe. I can think of two reasons. One, if it bombs, it makes the Xbox brand look bad major first party game tanked.
Yeah.
Also
two,
hurts the Fable brand. Yeah.
That's the other thing is
Hasn't
whatever
it already hurt the Fable brand.
But whatever's left of the Fable, whatever juice is left in the Fable IP, takes a huge hit if this game comes out and just sinks immediately. Yeah.
There's also like a little bit of a fallacy with stuff like that. I don't know what the name of it is. Justin was talking about it like a couple of weeks ago on History of Awesome for some reason, but like, there's this fallacy in business that's like, okay, well, if you have to cut your losses, there's an idea that you should just release the product anyway, because at least then you can recoup some of the costs that you put into development. And that's an erred way of thinking about things, because you shouldn't be thinking, I've already spent this much money, or like, I've already spent $10 million, I might as well spend an extra $5 million to get it out so that I can get $5 million back.
Right,
when
or
you should
$7
be thinking
million
about
back.
How much more money do I need to spend from this point on?
Yeah.
That's going to get me to where
exactly
I need to
right.
be.
Exactly
right. I mean, maybe more than you think.
I had a review done, written, ready to go for OXM of NBA Elite 11. The game was done, and EA canceled the game because they knew if that thing came out, it was. Now, granted, what followed, they ended up that whole franchise is a disaster anyway. But just, you know, you can't. But if they had shipped that game, they knew, like, wow, this is going to do irreparable damage to our NBA brand.
That was the basically T-Pose basketball
game,
right?
That was Jesus Bynum. Yeah. Yes, that was T-Pose Andrew Bynum at center court.
Andrew Bynum was on the cover?
No. This was a glitch that went viral because they did.
It was like
they released.
Floating
they,
around like that.
They made the, in hindsight, mistake of releasing a playable demo.
Ooh.
Like, I had the full game.
Yeah.
But they did release a playable demo to the public, and it was just loaded with. First of all, it was bad because it was a bad game, and it had all kinds of glitches in it, including the one Destin mentioned.
That's
the
famous
one.
What was your review score?
Tell
us. I
want to
say no. I'm trying to remember. I think I want to say a four something.
Oof.
Four something. Yeah.
4 out of 5.
No. Yeah,
this game is terrible. Play it. Highly recommend it.
Well, nowadays, like, bugs and glitches and stuff in games are kind
that's
of like
fun.
That's
the reason I played that Ride to Hell Retribution
like,
game.
Yeah.
What do you think Goat Simulator is? Like, that's a game that's like built on the idea that glitches can be awesome.
Yeah,
and
right.
I find
right.
it so funny that when Bethesda games release with glitches, it's like endearing.
Totally forget.
Yeah. People are like, aw, yeah, my dog's stuck in a wall again.
No
one's
as
ever
not,
mad about it.
As long as it's not game-breaking, it's
yeah,
fine.
Yeah, it's just funny.
But some of them are game-breaking.
Well,
in Bethesda games?
Yeah.
Sometimes?
Mm-hmm. I know a bunch of people who had game-breaking bugs in those games before.
I still think it's a minority.
No, it is.
Like, sometimes you can't
like,
get out of your
stuff.
House. It's a little frustrating, but you're like, all right, I can't get out of my house because a Brahmin's stuck in the door, and it looks totally ridiculous.
The glitches and bugs, like, they're definitely more charming when the game is super good, and that tends to be the case with Bethesda games.
I like every time I go to my settlement in Fallout 4, speaking of glitches, one of my companions are laying on the ground and a Brahmin standing on top of them. Then I wake them up and the Brahmin's just standing on them. It's pretty fun.
So anyway, the Fable Legends saga is not quite over yet.
Yeah.
We'll see what happens here. Probably sooner rather than later.
The staff will decide soon.
If this is true, which do we think it is?
No. I don't see it. Because Microsoft controls, I don't see Microsoft allowing, they own the IP. I don't see Microsoft allowing this game to be released.
I'm sure some of the staff is super passionate about the project,
of
wants
course.
To complete it.
Of course
but Microsoft's
are.
Just like, no, you guys got to let it go. Sorry.
So what if they just like pull a little switcheroo and call it like The Gathering. They just release it.
That's what they should have done to begin with.
Yeah.
Let's call it something else.
Change the name, yeah.
I should not have tattooed.
So this says, one source says the new offer is because of a proposal from some members of Lionhead to take Legends and continue development as an indie studio. I don't see that happening.
Right, I agree.
Like, that entire sentence sounds like Microsoft would just be like, no, you don't own Fable. Of course you can't do that. They wouldn't be like, maybe we should let you finish it.
Yeah.
Why?
We canceled this, but you know what? You guys go ahead. It's fine.
We invested millions of dollars into this project. Sure, you can have it. No, that's
I mean, maybe if they released it without the name Fable.
It's Microsoft's fault to begin with for going in this direction with the franchise. That's what's really.
I still think there'll be a Fable.
And that's what that's the whole thing that bothers me.
We think
like,
there'll be a Fable reboot.
My dream scenario was that Rare reboots it. They give it to Rare.
Isn't every Fable kind of like the Fable games aren't really connected? 2 and 3 are.
No, they are.
Like,
they're
set loosely.
Like, well, because they've been set like 500 years apart, so they're not like directly connected, but they are connected loosely.
But, I mean, if you made a 4 that wasn't connected to the other,
I think
three,
her point is like, what would a reboot of 1 look like if not just a new Fable game?
If not just like 2,
which is fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is totally.
No, I
fine.
Agree. I didn't know that there was a reboot. Or like a second reboot.
There was never a reboot.
There's three.
She's just saying
Fable
each one's
games.
Unique.
Yeah, and they're all just very different to each other. They don't ever feel
three
like
mainline Fables, plus two offshoots.
Yes. Fable 1 was always my favorite.
I want to see a really dark new film noir Fable.
I mean,
with
Fable,
a really serious
Fable 2,
tone.
Like, had, like,
no
some
humor.
Of that kind of feeling a little
Tell
bit.
Me, chicken. Do you bleed?
There we go.
That's not bad. That was pretty good.
Oh, my God.
My name's Chicken Chaser. What's yours?
I love those games.
Okay. And finally this week, another Microsoft news. Microsoft's E3 press conference will be at, drumroll please.
When?
The exact same time it always is. Monday.
So exciting.
Of E3 at 9:30 a.m.
I went to last year's E3 press conference for Microsoft.
They're fun.
It was awesome.
Yeah,
Microsoft does a good show.
Did you wear the bracelet? I had to wear the bracelet the year before that, I think.
Pulse.
Yeah. I also went to their Gamescom one.
Don't get out of here with your bracelets.
Yeah,
I wore a space poncho, my friend.
They learned their lesson. Now they just make you wear a bracelet that lights up randomly.
Wait, wasn't last year a necklace?
It might have been a necklace, but one year I had to wear a bracelet that lit up, and I'm
they do that.
Yeah, I'm not going to do
that. E3 last year is when they announced backwards compatibility, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That literally brought the house down when
I had
in there.
No idea.
It
was
so loud.
I think I swore. I was just straight up swore out loud because I had no idea that they were ever going to do
and
that.
And no one would have heard you because everyone was yelling.
It was amazing.
It was so loud. Like, it was crazy because I remember talking to...
That was my favorite moment of E3 last year.
Yeah, me too. I remember talking to, I forget who it was, but it was one of the higher up dudes.
Yay, old thing. Woo! Old things we already have. Woo!
It might have been
fan of old things.
Yeah, it might have been actually when we did unlocked that same E3 with the Xbox bosses.
Yeah.
I think it was Phil who was saying like it was a big moment to announce something like that and have a reaction like that at E3 because it wasn't just like a Xbox thing. Like Satya Nadella, the CEO of Microsoft, was there in the audience.
Oh,
and stuff.
Right,
like,
right, yeah.
A lot of the bigger dudes who were like, "What's this Xbox thing that Microsoft is doing?" Were there, and like he thought it was just awesome. I thought it was awesome.
Did anyone at IGN know about that prior to it being announced?
If anyone would have, it would have been you.
Yeah, no comment.
I just vaguely said,
let's
did
later.
Anyone know about that?
Yeah.
I did not know.
I didn't either.
Yeah.
All right.
BioWare, Microsoft, what is going on with Mass Effect? Where's 2 and 3? You have backwards compatibility for 1, but not 2 and 3? Let me play the whole
game.
Sure
that is weird.
Coming.
Yeah.
That is
just
weird.
One. And it's also Steam. Steam, you can get just Mass Effect 1.
I wonder,
you have to go to Origin now and get 2 and 3.
In all seriousness, I wonder if 1 came first and
it was platform exclusive.
Right, because because Microsoft published it.
Oh, that's right.
Back when and 2, whereas 2 and 3 were, you know,
back
they
in the early
to
days
to
of Xbox 360, it actually had the far superior exclusive library. BioShock
totally.
Also was.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
Oh my God, it was too.
Yeah.
God, I forgot
Man,
about
Mass
that.
Effect, BioShock, that.
Yeah.
Early Xbox
Halo,
360
Dead Rising,
amazing.
War
Saints
Dead Rising.
Row.
Yeah, it took like
Saints Row 2?
Saints Row 1 was
had
an Xbox 360 exclusive.
It took like 3 or 4 years for PlayStation for those games to migrate over to PlayStation 4. Yeah.
And even Lost Planet, like the graphical capability was like
mind-boggling.
Yeah. Oh, the first Mass Effect? Dude, it looks terrible now, but back in the day, I remember nothing being beautiful.
It's still playable, though. Like, there's some games that look so bad that playing them is grating now. Mm-hmm. Mass Effect 1 still holds up.
The narrative design so good.
Do you remember Mass Effect 1, like, killing your 360? Like, mine would just, like, convulse. Like, I could hear it vibrating and, like, its fans spinning so fast, like, trying to keep that thing running.
Yeah.
It was terrible on my 360.
All right. Anyway, the only other note I wanted to make on this the E3 press conference thing is, even though it's the same time as it's always been, Monday, 9:30 a.m., it used to be the first thing of E3. Like, all right, Microsoft press conference, kicking off E3. Here we go. Now it's like literally the middle of E3.
Yeah.
With all the, like, Bethesda and EA and all the Sunday stuff going on.
There's more conferences this year, or more conferences every year than there seems to be the previous year. But did you guys see that report that says, like, total number of vendors at E3 has decreased, like, by 60%?
Yeah.
Like, it used to be like 300, really 350, and now it's like 100, 150.
Yeah. ESA has been focusing on, like,
that?
Well, ESA has just been letting everybody in, basically. And I think vendors are just kind of like, why don't we just do it ourselves at this point?
Yeah.
Like, who cares anymore?
I mean, floor space has to be really expensive.
Yeah,
oh, clearly.
And when, like,
you
know, EA is doing EA Play, I feel like everyone else is like, good idea. Let's do that.
Yeah. I think next year will be a turning point one way or the other for E3. E3 2017.
Yeah, well, this year is going to be the test.
Right. Either EA, rather, the ESA sort of makes changes to lure everybody back in to the convention center, or it goes the other way and people are like, well, forget it. Everybody's going to do their own thing. There will be no, like, convention center kind of thing.
There will always be an E3. People will go there.
There's Nintendo Direct, so, like, couldn't every company just eventually just do that? Like Final Fantasy?
Well, I don't know if Nintendo Direct's, in my opinion,
again,
the best way to deliver news.
We'd come full circle to E3 2007, where everybody did their own thing, and so
it was a disaster.
It all canceled each other out, and nothing stood out, and it was just dust in the wind.
They're better.
I also
about
don't
it
think
now.
Like, a lot of the smaller companies probably don't have the resources to do something like that. But I don't know. I mean, I think it's a bummer. I love the idea of a convention and a centralized location.
Yeah, me too.
Like, all the press and kind of, like, games industry people descend upon LA for a week.
It's cool.
That's the thing. I still love E3. I've been to, like, 12 of them. I love it every year. I look so forward to it. I'm so happy to get there. I love E3 for the spectacle and just everything under one roof. And, what am I going to see behind closed doors today? I love it. And I would hate to see it turn into just this, like, weird, Monday is EA's thing and Wednesday is like,
at the same time, it's gotten very frustrating. Like, when I have to do direct feed and I have to do interviews on the floor and do all this crazy stuff for IGN during the week, like, it's tough to see a bunch of people who, quite frankly, are not there to do a job in my way, kind of making my job harder.
Again, we've talked many times about how, like, because you're right, Alana, is by all accounts, the floor space is, the booths are super expensive. And it's crazy money, and that's what happened the last time in 2007. Everybody said, "Why are we spending all this money? Forget it." And then they all realized, okay, that didn't go well. We'll go back and we'll have an E3.
But they learned from those mistakes, probably.
We've talked about, like, why not just do it the way Gamescom and TGS do it?
Gamescom.
Have public days after where you can charge admission. Everybody keeps their booth set up and manned, and you recoup your costs that way.
Anyway, so last year I was there for BBC, which I would think is a fairly reputable outlet.
Gamescom or E3?
E3. But I didn't have the IGN benefits, which meant that, like, sometimes I was, even for BBC, I was waiting in a line for 2 hours to play a game, even though I had an appointment.
Wow.
It was like, I'm trying to cover your game for an outlet. I'm media.
A big
and
outlet.
I'm waiting for 2 hours to play Unravel. Like, that was insane. Like, they specifically wanted that game as, like, a narrative-driven game. It was like, why? Like, who are these people in this line? Do we all have appointments? Like,
ESA runs E3, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I notice all their press releases are, like, record-breaking attendance numbers and everything. They're letting more and more people in.
Mm-hmm.
That's true.
Major outlets are getting less and less coverage time for these properties.
And it's just kind of like, well,
you're not going to find anybody in our audience that's gonna really sympathize with us on that one.
Well, no, I'm not.
You better, once IGN can't cover any of the stuff you want to hear about, you better sympathize with us.
Well, like, Finnegan,
they might
down.
Be able to, they might be able to do the public day thing, but like, I feel like the ESA's goals and what E3 should be, E3 is like, not a lot of people get in. You know, this is major exclusive stuff.
Well, it's supposed to be a trade.
And they've opened it up to celebrities and stuff.
You celebrities know. I get, yeah, because those people have reach, but it's the people who have like 5,000 subscribers on YouTube. Not that that's a bad thing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when there's 20 or 30 of them all in a row and they're all taking up the time that doesn't allow people like us, or not even us because we're big.
I wouldn't even say YouTube is that a problem. It's like there's people who
are... The cosplayers? A bunch of people cosplaying who are just playing a game, and I'm like, I'm trying to cover this for our audience who really wants to see it. You're just playing it. You're not going to write anything.
Well, I'm pretty sure that, like, if you, like, know someone who works at Best Buy, then you can, like, get a ticket by being associated with them as just a consumer. So I think that's kind of the problem, is all the people who actually aren't doing anything and are just walking around.
ESA is encouraging it by talking about record-breaking attendance numbers. Like,
they're proud of that, whereas when I read that, I'm like, please stop.
Yeah. It's like, hard. The other struggling outlets that are trying to cover properties like this aren't getting time with games.
Yeah, I mean, the 2 hours that I spent waiting for Unravel was 2 hours that meant that I couldn't play anything.
And you're a huge BBC isn't small.
And they were still and the person next to me in the line was just like there for fun, and I was like, God, God damn it. Yeah. Like, come on.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, people in our audience get a little ticked off when we whine about these things. I don't mind. I'm going to whine because, like, it's a bummer. We're there to do a job, and things that prevent us from doing our job, we rightly
think... I mean, I would argue with you on the YouTuber thing. Like, I think that it's really good that people have... Like, if you don't let people who are producing content into E3 because they're not big enough, they can't get bigger. So I would, like, encourage YouTubers to be able to go, but I don't think people
E3's
who aren't...
E3's not the only trade show in the world, though.
I have a problem with people that are going and doing nothing.
Yes.
Stop letting
them in.
That's all I
have a problem
with. Oh, did you cover it last year? No, you're not in this year.
Yeah, that's the only part that I have an issue with, is
Ryan's
going and
go.
Not covering it.
I'm waiting to rein it in.
I think there should be, you know, like a level cap, right? Not a level cap. Like a minimum bar of entry. Like, it's not as if you're producing content or not producing content. That's good. I'm all for people who want to produce content out of it. But at some point, it's like, okay, we can let the people who have 100,000 subs or more, if they're doing YouTube specifically content, or if they have a site or a .com, like, I don't know, there should be a priority list for these things. Because the problem with YouTube is, like, yeah, it allows everyone in the world to produce content, and at some point, you just can't let everyone in the world.
Sean Finnegan's one percenter E3 will be held
That's the thing, always has been a one percenter thing in the games industry. It should stay that way.
I've been on both sides. I've worked for IGN. I've made my own website and run it for like 6 months, and I had enough of a following that they're like, okay, we know you've worked in media, we'll let you in, you know, but I barely got in. And now just anybody can get in. They're like, do you have Twitter? Sure, go for it. But like, when you fill out that form, it's like, what are the three stories
really
you've written in the last 6 months and everything? I'm like, how are these people getting in? I don't get it, you know?
So they know people.
They want Best Buy people. I think that the ESA probably just wants money.
Yeah. And that's unfortunate because it's tarnishing what E3 represents and what it is.
Do you pay for tickets if you're not media?
You can pay a ton of money for tickets.
But I think those numbers are limited.
Prohibitively expensive. It's like $500 for a half day.
And there's only like 5,000 of them.
I'm exaggerating, I'm guessing, but it is very high.
Well, yeah. Xbox last year, didn't they give away a bunch of passes as well? Like 500 to...
I don't think
it was Xbox, it was Square Enix.
Well, I think several publishers had.
Oh, yeah. Several.
Yeah.
The one I remember very specifically...
you get 10 free passes or something.
The one I remember very specifically was Square Enix put out a tweet being like, if you follow us on Twitter and tweet with this hashtag, you have a chance to win one of our passes. And they had like 1,000 of them or 2,000 of them. That's, for just like random people.
That's the kind of stuff that I wish wasn't at E3, but I still think the best option is the Gamescom option where you have media days so people who are there for work don't get too frustrated. And then let other people, even YouTubers,
everybody wins.
Yeah.
That's how it should be.
Media wins, public wins, ESA wins, problem solved. I don't understand why.
Glad we did that for them.
Yeah.
There you go. So 30 minutes later, sorry, I opened that Pandora's box. Let's go to the Marketplace report. Alana, what can we be spending our money on this week?
Retail. Dark Souls 3 just came out. That came out.
It's good.
When this will be live, it'll be 2 days ago. Came out on Monday. It's
excellent. Tuesday.
Yeah, no joke. I've never played a Dark Souls game before, but all of the coverage we've been doing has made it seem really cool, and I think I might get into it.
Dark Souls is incredible.
It's good.
I highly recommend it.
Good.
Digitally, we have Blues and Bullets Episode 2 for $5. LetaQuest Grimm's Journey Remastered for $10, and that one's a turn-based RPG. Enigmatis, the Ghost of Maple Creek, is $10, but has a free trial adventure game.
Again with the naming.
It's a terrible name.
Again with the naming.
And Tickbold, a dodgeball adventure, $8, which is a fantasy dodgeball game. I wonder what that
It looked like an interesting
exactly.
little party game, like a little four, like 2 to 4 player top-down party thing.
Cool.
Text-based adventure.
Just kidding.
I love those.
What else?
About dodgeball?
Marketplace, Halo 5's Warzone Firefight beta.
Shark, you went up and played it. The beta starts now, I think, by the time people hear this.
I did. I did
what
a little
think,
bit of a preview.
Friend?
I did a little preview that's live on IGN. We had it exclusively for the last week. It's fun. It's a lot of fun, actually. Like, I like it more than regular Warzone. It's still Firefight, like in its DNA, wave-based, very cooperative, pretty intense. Except now you get access to all of your requisitions, and there's cool mechanics and awesome bosses, and you could fly around in a banshee and shoot.
And you
stuff
got a clock ticking at this point too, right?
Yeah, 5-minute rounds. Like you have to achieve your objective with your team in that 5 minutes, or else you lose on the spot.
That's
it's
cool.
not
nice.
Like infinite waves survive as long as you can anymore.
It's like just camp in the corner.
Yeah, it's, yeah, not time. Like that at all. It's a unique blend of Warzone and Firefight in the Warzone sandbox, which I think is real cool.
Yeah.
They plan to bring it to all maps. A lot of cool new bosses. It's just fun. It's fun.
Great. Man, I'm so happy to hear that.
Yeah, read my preview. It's live on IGN. But if you know, by the time this is out, the beta will be live.
Beta's up, yeah.
So you should just go play it.
Awesome. We also have the...
Well, you should also go watch the video so I can
please.
Have a video of you.
Yeah, please.
Just one.
Yeah.
We also have the Battleborn open beta, and Insurgents are out for the Division.
Incursions.
Oh, yes. Insurgents.
Yeah.
Insertions. That's
yeah,
a
that's, like a type of cut.
That's a different DLC.
That's, yeah. That goes with the VR.
Destiny's stuff. April update also hit the same day as the Incursions. We did a live stream about
what,
it, so you can check out
what
that
is. Incursions? What are they?
Incursions is basically the Division's raid.
Yeah.
It
oh,
is
cool.
a 15-round wave-based thing where you're trying to take out a tank, basically.
Oh, man.
So you have to work with your 4-man team, and there are team-based sort of things that you have to do, like... somebody has to be over here to press a button. You both press a button. Somebody puts a bomb at the back of the tank. It blows up. Next round starts, and you're dealing with waves of enemies
sounds
while all
pretty
this
good.
Is going on.
Yeah, it does sound
pretty
good.
It's pretty fun. It's
also
very
sounds
difficult.
Very different to the main game.
Yeah, it's very difficult. You got to
like,
go in
do
with
that
like a.
Also being in cover.
Well, you run around a lot. Like
so
there's sniper rounds, there's drone rounds, there's rusher rounds, and you kind of deal with all of that while you're going with the mechanic. You got to go in with like I recommend like a 180 gear score team. They also added a ton of updates to the Dark Zone, including like supply drops. There's weekly and daily missions. This is a huge update for the
level
Division.
Level cap is still 30, right?
Yes, okay. But now your gear score is how your end game works. It's kind of like Destiny with exotics.
Yeah. Okay.
On the Destiny side, there's a new Prison of Elders mode. Your light level has been increased to 335. Ryan's really trying to move on, but there's a huge Destiny update
I have to go like
also.
In 20 minutes for an appointment.
Yeah, we're,
so.
We're way over.
Today, so,
sorry.
Yeah. For April on
Games
Xbox,
with Gold.
Games with Gold. We have The Wolf Among Us all month long and Sunset Overdrive from the 16th to the 15th of
yes.
next month. Sunset Overdrive is incredible.
Yeah,
apparently
seriously.
So is Wolf Among Us. Haven't played it.
Wolf Among Us is also incredible.
Oh, so good.
On Xbox 360
These
we have
great.
Dead Space, also incredible. Mm-hmm. And Saints Row 4, oh my god, also incredible.
Yeah.
Those are all very, very
They're
good
awesome.
Games.
I'm a Saints 3 guy, but 4 is good.
I love 4. It's so much fun.
4 went... too far off the deep end for
I
me.
I just like being able to fly.
But it's a good game. Yeah, it's
what?
You can fly in Saints Row.
You're basically like
Never
a superhero.
Never played
Saints Row.
I always just remembered it as like kind of a GTA knockoff. In
it started that way.
Right?
The first one was, and then they just went super goofy.
Play Saints Row the Third because it's like it's that exact tipping point where it's still grounded in reality, but it's pretty goofy and funny at the same time.
Yeah.
And then 4 is just like, where do we go from here?
Yeah,
I guess it's
utterly ridiculous.
And then it went to hell
fun.
After that.
Yeah, and that was bad. That wasn't good.
Anyway.
But yeah, great lineup of games though.
Excellent. All right. Stay tuned for the interview with Rod Ferguson, the studio head at the Coalition on Gears of War 4, right now. All right, our special guest on Podcast Unlocked this week is none other than Rod Ferguson. You know him as the right hand of Cliff Bleszinski during the early years.
Wait,
no.
Things he does with his right hand, I do not want to be associated with.
You know what? He was just in here. That's probably fair. All right, so we'll move on past that. You were the fixer at Irrational Games on BioShock Infinite. You had a brief detour over to 2K Marin
yep.
for some stuff, which I wanted to ask you about
just
for
more
in
of a
second.
Journey of finding myself. Some people backpack across Europe or walk through, you know, Australia. I just switch around game companies for a couple of
years. Yeah, and now you're at the newly renamed the Coalition, formerly Black Tusk, right. And you are working on all things Gears of War related, starting Absolutely. With Gears of War 4.
Correct.
Which we just played. You'll see by the time this airs, the coverage will all be up on IGN. And there are worse ways to spend an afternoon than spending like 3 hours playing Gears of War 4's multiplayer beta. So, Rod, the first thing I wanted to ask you was about backtracking a second. You have a big history with the series, but then you headed off and you were very much credited with helping get BioShock Infinite done and out the door, which turned out to be a great game. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, you were working on what the rumor was, Mafia 3.
Right.
So what led to you not working on that anymore? Because that's a big series too. That's been sort of in development for a long time. The sure. third one.
It's just sort of a misalignment of goals. I think yeah. is probably the easiest way to say it. It's just and so I realized that what I was looking for and what they wanted were not necessarily the same things. And so, I decided that it was probably best for me to leave. And it was worked out crazy because I left 2K and then I phoned a friend of mine at Microsoft and said, hey, I've left 2K and I want to start my own game studio. Do you want to come with me? And he's like, wait, what? And I said, I left 2K. And he goes, well, we're looking to get Gears, so if you're free, that changes a bunch of stuff. And I'm like, oh, you're getting Gears? Okay, that sounds great.
Well, that was my next question. So was that serendipitous, where it just kind of worked out?
Yeah, I didn't know that Microsoft was getting it until I phoned them. I phoned my friend to say that I was going to form my own company, and he was like, hey, you should come and do this. And I was like, in a minute, because I still wanted to keep working at Gears, even at Epic. And it was only when Epic said, you know, we're putting this on the shelf, we're going to do other things, that I was like, okay, I think it's time for me to go then.
So, yeah, I'm curious. So, you know, you actually were at Microsoft producing, if I remember correctly, on the Microsoft side with Gears 1?
Yeah, I mean, I'd been on the Gears title for 6 months as a Microsoft producer. And I was seeing that they were having struggles. And so that was one of the things where I said, and I had just come off Counter-Strike Xbox, where we had basically had to pull that entire game in-house. So that was really my first experience of doing, like, being the lead producer for internal development as opposed to being a publishing producer. Mm-hmm. And I really got a taste for it. Like once you do it, it was like, oh, that's what I want to do. And so I went back to being a publishing producer for 6 months, and I just looked at Epic and like, they're really struggling on the production side. I think I could really help. And plus, that's what I really want to do with my career. And so it was an interesting conversation with my wife where, because I'd already gone through the process and then I'd signed the deal and all this stuff. And she was like, wait a second. You're leaving a company of 63,000 to go be employee number 63. Like, we could have the entire company in our front yard for a barbecue. And I'm like, yeah. And she's like, are you crazy? It's like, fortunately, I'd already signed, so she had no way to make me sick.
So you were, of course, you worked on Gears pretty much all the way through. And
yeah, for
7 years. I'm curious, when you take the Coalition gig and lead the new generation of Gears of War, do you call Cliff, since that was his baby? Do you kind of look for his blessing, or
no?
I mean, I'm just curious. I don't know how it works, you know.
Yeah, no. I mean, Cliff's doing his own thing with Lawbreakers.
Yeah.
And it was clear, like, you know, Cliff had moved on. So I was like, you know, it was one of the things I really wanted to make sure that the Coalition felt like it owned its own vision.
Yeah.
So I snuck some concept art to Chris Perna early on to say, like, dude, what do you think? Because Chris is really the monster guy. And so I was just like, what, you know. Is this cool to you? Because it's cool to me. And he came back with really positive stuff. And so I was really excited about that. But no, I haven't talked to Cliff about the game specifics at all. I mean, the one thing we did do, like, because we had to start the, you know, right away. Like, when I got there, like, you know, Black Tusk had been working on another game. So we had a pretty large, we didn't have a 10-person pre-production team. We had a pretty fully, you know, staffed up team. So we were just looking, like, what's the quickest way to get going? And so I flashed back to what we had done 3 years previous, where we'd done some pre-production work on Gears 4 at Epic. And so there's some elements there that we're like, oh, there's an interesting character name, and there's an interesting monster name, and there's some concepts that we think maybe we could develop. And so that was one of the things where, instead of going like, okay, let's start fresh and reimagine everything, we're just like, hey, there was some stuff that I really liked when I was at Epic. Let's just start there. And then within 2 weeks, we had a story, and then the monster started to fall out of that. It was a great sort of like, hey, I already have an idea, let's go.
That's crazy, because Gears 4 is one of the rare titles where it was announced the day you started working
right,
on it, because you know Microsoft buys the IP, and then you're like, okay, well, here we go, we're gonna start now. We got Unreal Engine 4, and
right.
and we're off.
Right.
So, and it'll end up being about 3 years on the game, right? By the time it ships.
Yeah, totally. And that's the thing. It's like And we're starting fresh. Like, when you look at Gears 1, I mean, Gears 1, honestly, was a 5 to 6 year title by the time they went through all the iterations and started as Warfare. It was a Battlefield competitor, and then it changed midway through to become a story-based game. And so there was a lot of effort went into that. So for us to go from nothing, like, a new engine, new team, no concept, like, you know, on day one in January 2014, to go from that to, okay, now we're shipping, like, That was why I took some of the shortcuts. It's like, we don't have time to go on some mystic journey of exploration. You know, we have some good ideas already about JD Phoenix and about a bunch of other stuff. Let's just start executing.
So I'm curious, how did you feel about the E3 reveal last year?
So in the moment, it felt great. In the post it, I realized what we had kind of gone too far. Like, one of the things I try to push for people, like, one of my philosophies is, don't do anything halfway.
Yeah.
Right. And so when we're doing stuff, like, either when you're like trying to show a feature off, I'm either keep it gray box and simple so people know that it's a work in progress, or finish it, but don't find some middle ground where people are uncertain about what it is they're seeing. And what had happened is that we wanted to do an announcement. And normally an announcement would be, here's a logo, maybe a piece of voiceover. Like, look at their GDC, the black on red thing, right? We weren't ready. The art wasn't ready. The texture, I mean, that's why it's black and red, is because the textures weren't, you know, we just weren't done. And so that was the true tease. And we, in our development of going through from pre-production into production, we had built this little visual target test for ourselves. And we're like, you know, this visual target is actually coming up really nicely. Like, we like how it looks and has a good sense of the tone. I'm like, instead of teasing people with just a logo and a voiceover, why don't we just blow their minds by having something really cool with our visual target? And so we were all bought into that. And so we went, and in my mind, and I played that live on stage, and I was like, this is going to be awesome. And what ended up happening is people didn't, because it was so polished, nobody took it as a tease. People said, oh, this is a demo of gameplay.
Right.
They all misinterpreted what it was. Instead of going like, holy crap, that's the best looking tease I've ever seen. They were like, huh, that gameplay doesn't look like Gears of War to me. It's a little slower pace. Like, you know, in terms of, because we walked down the street and we weren't doing a lot of fighting and that kind of stuff. And so I think that was where I would go, huh, in hindsight, I felt like we'd done a halfway thing again. Like, we weren't so limited on, it was just a, you know, an image with a voiceover, so very minimalist, or it wasn't a full demo, that we picked this middle ground, and probably in hindsight I wouldn't do that.
So let's talk about the 30 frames per second campaign, 60 frames multiplayer decision that you guys made. So I'm all for it, because I want, to me, part of what makes Gears is, it just blows me away from a technical visual perspective.
Right.
I tweeted out my opinion and got a surprising, like, there is a huge polarization on this, at least from my Twitter sample size audience.
Right. So both of them were upset? That's
yeah, well. But so I'm curious if you wouldn't mind kind of elaborating on that decision, including what benefits you're going to get, what tangible on the screen benefits you're going to get from players, because I think there's a lot of, maybe I'm projecting here, but a lot of younger generation players that have kind of more come up on Call of Duty and they've been told, well, 60 frames is great and anything less is horrible. In fact, that's what they tweeted me, like, oh, anything less than 60 is terrible. Like, well, aren't you all playing Destiny right now?
Right.
But so, yeah, I'm curious if you can elaborate on the decision a bit.
Oh, sure. Well, it's just about that, right? It's the notion of wanting to push the visuals as hard as possible in the campaign. And so, and there's also other aspects. Like, when you look at your frame rate, there's a number of elements that go into it. Part of it is rendering, right? So there's GPU constraints that once you start to do everything you do on the screen eats up milliseconds to the point where now you're getting down to it. And things like scene density and how much stuff you're drawing and outlock, all those sorts of things, and the quality of the textures and that and resolution of the textures. So there's a GPU side, but there's also a CPU side. And so by the number of monsters you want on screens, the amount of AI that's running is going to eat up your CPU, which is going to slow you down too.
Yeah.
And so that's why it's actually easier for us to do 60 in multiplayer and 30 in campaign, is because in multiplayer you really don't have the AI dependencies that you have in single player. And that and you can make multiplayer arenas be a little bit cleaner in terms of not having to have the same object density and you know, you can kind of scale some of that stuff back. So for us, it was like, what's most important to us in the campaign has always been to blow people's minds visually. And then but when you're playing competitively in a multiplayer, obviously responsiveness is most important, and that's why we wanted to push 60. So we felt like that was the right trade-off, is to push visuals in campaign and to push responsiveness in multiplayer.
All right. So Marcus Phoenix is the next guy I want to ask you about.
Okay.
It's really seems to be really hard to create a an iconic hero.
Right.
And you guys did that
right.
with the original Gears series.
Right.
And, you know, when 343 took over Halo,
right.
they didn't leave Chief behind.
Sure.
Like, kind of R with five, but that's another story entirely.
Right.
So you've made the decision to not have Marcus Fenix, unless
right.
you're pulling some sort of red herring on me, which
right.
I wouldn't mind. So is Marcus in the game, and do you feel like there's a risk leaving him behind, if in fact that is the case?
Well, I mean, clearly it's a risk, right? I mean, one of the things for us was when we looked at where we were in the next game, there was a choice of whether to do it easy or do it right. So the do it easy, especially given where I had a new team, a new engine, all this stuff,
yeah.
was to say, like, okay, Gears 4, we were wrong. The Locusts are back, and it's Marcus and the squad, and it's 3 weeks later or 6 months later,
right.
and it's basically the same game, but with a few more features and that kind of stuff. And we felt like that's an easy way to do it, but it doesn't give us that sort of a foundation to go even further into the future. And so for us, when we looked at it, we said, you know what we need is to build a foundation for a saga that we can go someplace and explore. And we, you know, like a prequel didn't make sense because we kind of bang into your own game. You know, an alternate planet didn't make sense because you kind of lose what makes Gears, like Sarah isn't meaningful. And we even talked about an origin story, but then it becomes the Spider-Man thing, and I don't want another Marvel
right,
series,
right.
right? So for us, that idea of creating these younger heroes, these 25-year-olds, where now through games you can actually develop them and create their character. Like Marcus is a late 40s, you know, character. He's kind of set, his personality. You notice
yeah.
Marcus doesn't really change. The world changes around Marcus, but Marcus doesn't really change. And so having this, building a foundation of new cast means we have a lot of places where we can go now, and we can actually see these characters change and develop as we play through the saga that will be the future of Gears.
So for me, one reason I asked you about how you thought the reveal went at E3 is because I'm a person who's a Gears of War fan, and I wasn't as excited as I wanted to be
sure.
by the reveal, and part of that was I just didn't get a sense of JD being super interesting. Of course.
Sure.
There's virtually like no dialogue, so so there's a bit of trade-off there. But you know,
yeah.
first impressions count, right?
Oh,
so
totally.
I'm curious what sort of going into, what are you guys doing to try and make JD a compelling, interesting character, the same way that there's some magic formula that made Marcus good?
Well, I mean, part of it is I think so there's a bunch of things going through my head
Do
to
it.
Answer that. So I mean, part of it is that I think some people forget about where we started. So when I talk to people about Delta Squad, people go like, "Brothers to the end," and all the da-da-da-da-da-da. I'm like, have you played Gears 1 lately? Because Marcus and Baird hated each other, and Dom was always talking about knocking out his teeth and calling each other. Like, they were not friends.
Right.
And it took going through 1, 2, and 3 to get to where they got to, where people were like, oh, Brothers to the End, yeah, Delta Squad. And
yeah.
Yeah, that took 3 games, guys. Like, it's not, that wasn't image 1, right, frame 1. And so for us, too, is just like the notion of, you know, we had no time for backstory in Gears 1. When I came onto that, we didn't have a story, and we had content, but we didn't know where we were going with it. And so we didn't have time to really develop it, so really we went after archetypes. And even like initially, it was Cole was the scientist, and Baird was the sports hero, and we tried all these things, and it just because it didn't register right away, we ended
yeah.
up kind of simplifying it to these archetypes of like, oh, okay, any given Sunday football guy, got it, right? And our goal in terms of trying to make the story and the characters more contemporary, like 10 years later, is to look at, well, you know, look, to me, this is not a great comparison, but the Tim Burton to Christopher Nolan thing. Like, Tim Burton Batman is very
yeah.
much, it's the comic book, and Christopher Nolan has a lot more nuance. And,
true.
And so we'll never be as dark as a Christopher Nolan Dark Knight, but the notion of there's more gray in their stories, and there's more things to learn about, and there's more nuance, so it's not like I can sit here and go, here's my 3-word summary of JD as a character. I can't do that, because there's more to JD than that. And plus, he's young, so my hope is that through the future games that you'll actually, then he'll actually crystallize and form in your mind. So for me, it's about, Gears 4 is about going on a journey of discovery. You're discovering this new monster. This is the emergence day for the swarm. You're the first person to ever see the monster, and you get to play that and discover that. And as part of that, you'll also discover these 3 characters and their relationships and who they actually are. So it's not just a one-sided discovery. And so it's kind of, you have to play it. And I know that's hard from a, you haven't sold them to me yet.
Right, right.
But that's part of what, you know, like I would prefer not to market this game at all if I could get people to buy it without marketing it, because I didn't want to reveal the story.
Yeah, a lot of developers are that way, right? Just
right.
like play it when it's done.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's like, you know, hey, we're going to market The Sixth Sense and say there's ghosts or something. Like, I don't want to do that, right?
What?
Yeah, spoiler. And so the notion of, like, I wanted to hold the swarm back because that is the game's discovery, but you have to, you know, people are concerned, what are you doing with my
yeah.
game, right? So we have to say, no, it's still a monster game. So for us, it's just finding that, but I think that's why I'm saying the game, in all aspects of both the good, you know, the cast and the monster, is a journey of discovery that you have to go through. And my hope is that after playing Gears 4, you feel a lot closer to these characters and you care about them more.
What do you feel is your biggest challenge on this game? You know, this first project with your new team, bringing back this IP and really making it your own rather than, you know, Epic's game.
For me, it's just doing right by the fans. You know, that was the, when I stood up in front of the coalition for the first time, it was about, we got to do it right before we do it different. You know, because I walked in and people were, we have a very diverse group of people from very many different types of games and who had shipped AAA games before. But then so they were like, hey, we finally get our hands on Gears. Here's what I've never seen in Gears. And here's verticality. Here's this, here's that, here's that. And there was all these crazy, wacky ideas.
Yeah.
And I was like, guys, you haven't shown me you can even make cover yet. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you need to show me pacing. You need to show me fronts. And you need to show me. And so that was the thing where, to me, it was like, if at the end of it, what we want is this feels like a Gears experience. And that's what we were trying to get across from the multiplayer today, too, is like where we innovate selectively.
Right.
And things like the close cover combat mechanics and the weapon designs and the map designs. But what we want to go is like, oh, yeah, Gears is back on, in on it. It feels good. And that has been the number one mission above all.
Because it's I got to imagine as a developer, especially picking up where a franchise left off, it's got to be kind of a damned if you do, damned if you don't right. scenario, right? If you right. change too much, right. everybody's upset.
Right.
If you don't change enough, everybody's upset.
No, exactly. Like, I'd use this phrase, the betrayal of expectations, right? Like, you have to betray your customer. Because if you do just what they want, then they go, like, I've played this before.
Right.
And they don't know what you're trying to do. And so you have to, if you don't betray it enough, then not good. If you betray it too much, that's not the game I wanted. This isn't Gears anymore.
Yeah.
And so what you want to do is betray their expectations in such a way that those little betrayals become surprise and delight, where they go like, I never thought of that. That's cool. Like that kind of stuff, right? And so it is very much a line you have to walk where you go like, does it still feel like Gears? But yet, oh, I'm surprised or, you know, delighted by these changes.
You were very, in the presentation that we saw before we played, you were very careful to sort of connect with Gears 3 and kind of distance from Judgment a little bit.
Sure.
So what is it about Gears 3 that you think made it sort of the one that you're building off of?
Well, I just think if you look at the two, with Gears 3 and Judgment, like which one is the truest form of Gears? And it's 3 as a baseline, because 3 became the purest form of, you know, as we polished it from, you know, the cover system was a little clunky in one, and we shot from the camera, not the weapon, and those things. And so we just kept improving it, and it became, Gears 3 essentially became the best version of Gears. And then you look at a studio that's been working on Gears of War for 7 years, and they go like, hey, how can we mess with this a little? Like, what are the things we could do? And,
yeah.
And what you see in Judgment is this idea of like, hey, what if we started putting some first-person shooter stuff in? Like, maybe changing the controls would be interesting. What about if we did first-person shooter controls or first-person movement and offhand grenades and all this stuff, right? And so Judgment was really meant as a playground. And that was one of the things, because we thought we were going to make Gears 4 at Epic. And so we felt like, huh, we have this the non-numbered version. Why don't we throw some of our ideas that we think we might do in 4
yeah.
into Judgment and see how it lands, right? And so that's what's been great for us, is we treat Judgment as the experimental one, and we can go and say, okay, 3 is the baseline, but now what about Judgment is interesting that we could potentially bring back? And those things like, you know, they had a smoothness to the movement, they had a speed to the responsiveness that I felt like are things that we could definitely learn from and build into 4.
So it's like Judgment's like the concept album, and now the band, exactly. now you're getting back exactly. in the studio.
Exactly.
What's up with Horde mode? Because Gears 3, I think, had
the
most perfect Horde mode of that we at least that we've seen so far. I really loved all of the sort of base building defense, you know, tower defense kind of elements built into it.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're actually like that notion of co-op, that ability, like the playing with friends, is something that we feel is central to Gears. You know, it was everything we do. Like, we always say that co-op is the cake, not the icing, right? Because we never cut it. Back in 2006, yeah. everybody was cutting co-op, because it was that too hard feature that maybe not enough people used in their minds.
Right.
And so co-op became central to us. It was something we could never cut. And so now we're actually putting co-op into multiplayer versus, where we're saying, you know what, we're going to create a mode that people can go in and then matchmake on the same team and have 5 humans against 5 bots easily. So you can play socially and talk to people and strangers and make friends. You can learn from other players and their tactics. You can, and you're playing in a getting shotgun in the face by, you know, really skilled human
Thank
player.
Thank you for that, yeah. by the way.
So and then we're recognizing, you know, when you look at League of Legends, are people like 50% of the people never leave bot mode. They like 50% of the people never go online. And so we have to recognize that some people are going to hang out in co-op versus, and so we reward you with XP and that kind of stuff, so that we don't just treat it as a practice mode. We treat it as a viable place to go play.
I'm asking on behalf of Marty Sliva, one of the other guys who's normally on this podcast.
Okay.
He needs to know that there is razor hail in the game, because that's his favorite thing about Gears is razor hail.
Interesting. Okay. Well, let's just say there's extreme weather in the game. Does that work?
That's a good start. We'll take that for now. Okay. Last couple questions I have for you are sort of related. Do you feel like Black Tusk's other IP completely dead? I mean, we saw it. You're a studio that's built now to make Gears
All
of War games,
Gears,
but
yeah.
We did see a very neat concept trailer at E3, two or so years ago.
Right.
Is that done? Are we going to hand that off to another studio, or what do you think?
Well, I mean, I don't know what Microsoft's going to do with that sort of idea. I mean, right now it's not being worked on by anybody or anything, so it's on the shelf somewhere. But right now, the reason we rebranded ourselves as the Coalition is that we're dedicated to Gears and all things Gears. So
of course.
That's not something we're going to ever pick up.
And on a related note, so do you think now you've come back to Gears of War after a brief journey into the wilds?
You're finding myself.
Do you see yourself working on Gears for the rest of your career? Is that an interesting career path for you?
Yeah, if I'm lucky, that would be great. You know, I love Gears of War. I love playing it. I love building it and creating it. And there's a large part of me that's in that game. Like, when I look at that game, I see myself in it. So, like, I thought maybe Gears might be it for me. And I was happy with that. And I'm happy with that now. As I look forward and go, like, is this the last franchise I ever work on? I'd be totally fine with that. That would be great. You know, and that was why I got the tattoo. It was because it was the notion of, this was it. Like, I knew that it was not a temporary thing. This is a permanent thing.
I know, and I've seen it. Where is it?
Oh, it's right here.
Yeah, let's get it on. Let's get it. We can't zoom in because we don't
have
a but yeah,
good art,
it's
but
pretty
a
visible.
Frame. I have a very bad frame for this. So that to me was like,
that's dedication right there.
Well, I guess not many game creators go get their own logo put on their body, but to me it was just it spoke to my belief on that. I'm Gears Viking, and that's why I never changed my Twitter handle.
Yeah.
And it's funny is that that's what people. I walk down the street in New York, and the guy doing the comedy show tonight goes, Gears Viking, and like that's how they know me. And I realize it's defined my career, it defines me, and I define it, and I love that.
That's great. I love that you're that. I mean, it gives, as a player, it gives a lot of confidence that you adore your own thing enough to do that, because I sure as hell wouldn't put any game on my body.
You're gonna get an IGN logo on your
No. I love working here, but that's not happening. You know, my wife would divorce me. She'd be just like, clearly you are not capable of making rational decisions. Out the door. I've already been divorced once, Rod. I don't want to do it again. It's a horrible experience.
I can imagine. Well, that's the funny thing is my wife sleeps to my left, and occasionally when I roll over, like, the tattoo comes up, and she,
hey, honey.
And she goes, oh, God. She's like, that really happened.
Well, the game is Gears of War 4. The multiplayer beta begins April 18th. Do I have correct?
For anybody who's played the Ultimate Edition, either on Windows 10 or Xbox One,
yes.
If you've played, we'll send you a code and you'll get early access. We're going to roll the codes out because we're not doing a two-stage like pre-download start thing. We're just, when you get the code, you can play. So,
nice.
Because this is a real beta. Like, it's not a pre-release demo.
A marketing beta?
No, it's not a marketing beta. It's a technical beta. We have code that we've never run before at scale. And so our focus is all about launch day. And so it's going to be, hey, we want to roll things in and test servers as the load gets bigger and bigger. We want to make sure the gameplay is right. We want to make sure. So we're going to roll it out. So if you don't get it on 12:01 on the 18th, relax. It's coming.
Well, buckle up for all those angry tweets at Gears Viking.
Exactly. And so for the first week is the Ultimate Edition players. And then starting the 25th is anybody with a
25th.
Gold account.
All right. Excellent. And then full game October 11th. That's actually, we just talked about that on last week's podcast. I was surprised. I thought for sure that Microsoft likes to give their biggest tentpole game the November slot.
Right.
Did you guys have a say in that, or does Phil come down and be like, all right, you guys are out in October, let's do it?
No, we have a huge say in that. Because ultimately, your ship date is determined by your production schedule.
Yeah.
Right? So you can't be, you know, it's not, you can't have the tail wagging the dog. So we go in and we talk about that. And Gears 3 was out in September, so it's not unusual for us to change the time. And it was just it from where we were going to be in production and how things were shaping up, October just felt really good. And so it seemed like a natural date to target for us.
Brilliant. The earlier we get it, the better. We'll be happy. Starting with the beta. Rod Ferguson, the studio head at the Coalition on Gears of War 4. Rod, thanks so much for joining us.
Oh, thanks for having me. It was great.
All right, unlock block time. This one should be pretty easy. I knew this one right away. If you had a pulse in like 2009 in following the games business, you probably got this one right. So Hopefully you all did. Our question comes to us from Justin Ellefson from Boone, Iowa, who asks, in Brutal Legend, who voiced the main character, Eddie Riggs? Do you guys remember Tim Schafer's Brutal Legend, a real-time strategy game disguised as kind of an action game?
Mm-hmm. I like this game.
Yeah.
It was, in the end, it got a little complicated with the mechanics.
Yeah, like, I love Tim's game. Tim's games. This one was the one that just never quite clicked for me.
Oh, I like Metal, so I really liked it.
It would be my least favorite of Tim Schafer's games.
But still a great Tim Schafer game. Yeah. So was it, did Gary Oldman play that main character, Mark Hamill, Jack Black, or the great Patrick Stewart, Sir Patrick Stewart?
It would be so funny if it was Patrick Stewart.
It would be pretty hilarious if it was. Everybody's written down their answers. Alana, yeah. I'll go your way first. Do you remember?
It is C, Jack Black.
Shark?
I also have C, Jack Black.
Destin?
That's who it is.
That is correct. Yeah. Good job, everybody. Yeah. Let me add everybody's points here.
Hooray. I think that's my first point in 2016.
I've been gone for 3 weeks.
Your second point.
Is that my first point?
That is your first point, Alana, yes.
I've been gone for 3 weeks doing Destiny stream clip outs.
Brutal.
Yeah.
Legend.
Legend, yeah. Where are we at?
Destiny. So we have now Mitch still, the ghost of Mitch has 6 points.
All
right. Mitch win 2016?
Marty has 6. He's in Japan this week. Japan. And then Destiny, you're at 5. Shark 2, Alana 1. The year, it's a long year.
This is my second week. So
it's like a 50-week year. We've got like 40, probably 40 weeks to go. Mm. So
can we give Mitch one? He would have got that.
No.
He would have known. I tried to pull that last year.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, I would have known that was I here. But I wasn't. So.
All right.
Disallowed. The question is, what is the prize this year?
Oh.
Statue.
So it's funny you should ask.
A life-size statue.
I've been informed... that the trophy should be arriving here via mail this week.
Ooh.
And I'm very excited to see it. We'll talk all about it when it arrives. And then we'll go from there. Because, a listener made it. And I've seen some in-progress pictures, and it's going to be incredible.
Sweet.
So you'll want to win. You will want to win this year. It will be some serious incentive.
Mm.
If you want to win a video game, though, we've got copies of... the old 360 Gears of War games that are backwards compatible. We've got some Alan Wakes generously donated by you guys. And this week, Microsoft's finally sent out waves and waves of Quantum Break PC codes to everybody that had pre-ordered the Xbox version. And a lot of people kindly saying, oh, hey, I don't need the PC version. You guys want to give it away on Unlocked? Yes. If you've got a capable PC, like, the gameplay is awesome on PC, so we've got a number of copies of Quantum Break for PC. So Justin Ellefson from Boone, Iowa will have his choice of what's in the stash.
Thanks for the question and for listening.
Yeah, and if any of you out there want to win one of those games I just mentioned, send us your Xbox-related trivia question. Please include 4 multiple-choice answers and note the correct one in your email. And you too could win. Oh, you got to send that to where, Destin?
Unlocked at IGN.com.
Very good. I love you. You're still a little uncertain still, but you got it.
You said my name. My eyes went wide.
Like,
I'm
oh,
like,
my God.
Oh, I know this. Let's go.
All right. Let's get the heck out of here. It's late, and I haven't eaten anything.
Mm-hmm.
Got to go to a thing.
That's right.
I can't eat anything.
I'm going to LA.
Be happy.
Oh.
Yeah, still in recovery mode, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Shark. Tell you
wonton
what, Shark.
Soup.
Let's get some sympathy follows to go your way on Twitter. Tell us where we can find you and what you've been working on here.
Follow me at Shot by Finnegan on Twitter and on Instagram. Take
lots of photos. What are you, a murderer? Shot by Finnegan?
Filmed.
With a camera, not with a gun. One day I used to shoot weddings in college, and I told my friend what he was like, what'd you do today? I was like, I shot an elephant. And he was like, what? Turns out at Indian weddings, it is tradition for the bride and groom to ride into the reception on an elephant.
That's awesome.
So
and
it was really cool.
It?
No, I shot it with a camera, Destin. Like I said, I did the Halo 5 Warzone Firefight preview. It's live on IGN right now.
Or YouTube.
Yeah, or YouTube. Check that out as well. It's all over my Twitter. It's real cool, and we got a really huge amount of hands-on time with it. Also embedded in the preview are 2 cool dev commentaries that I did with 2 of the developers up there. So if you want some deeper insight, check those out. Lastly, I did the April Fool's Star Wars on Netflix video, which I worked for like 2 months on. It's like the prime reason for me not being on this show or anywhere ever. So check that out. It's like at 1.5 million views right now. I really hope to get it up there even more. But like every view counts. Share it with your friends, and hopefully you think it's awesome.
Sweet. Destin?
Yeah, so IGN first for No Man's Sky.
Not an Xbox game, but anyway.
That's what I'm working on.
It is on PC.
Yeah, follow me on Twitter, at Destin Legarry. So that's been released on IGN. I'm working on a video that's coming out this Friday. I'm not going to say what it is yet, but we talked about it before on the show. I think people are really going to enjoy that. And other stuff, but yeah.
And also,
my
other
phone
things.
Was vibrating the whole show because it's like updating all the projects I have right. in the works. So yeah, but those are two of the big ones.
Turn off those push notifications.
Yeah.
Alana.
I'm on Twitter and Instagram at @CharAlanaZad, and today actually I'm going to be finishing a review of Chronos, which is an Oculus Rift exclusive that I really like. It's a lot like Darksiders.
Nice.
I'm also writing up a feature of the coolest Halo toys ever.
Oh,
which is
very relevant
very
to our
relevant.
Audience. Yes.
And lastly, last week I just wanted to give a shout out to a cosplayer I featured for his Lara Croft Tomb Raider cosplay.
Oh yeah.
He goes by Tom Brader. I think it's incredible. It's really, really, really cool. It's just like a gender swapped.
I get it.
Destin.
Wait,
also
it's a
Tomb Raider.
Reference?
It's also spells Tomb Raider, Sean.
But Tom also Brady? Tom Brady.
I don't think it's a reference to that
no.
at all.
No, it's Tomb Raider, but well, it's like, a guy.
Okay, well, I thought it was funny because it works on two levels.
How does that work? It's not even. Anyway.
It would only be.
Tomb
it
Raider.
Only,
Tom
it would only work
Brader.
If it was Tom Brady dressed up as Tom Brader.
Then well, you haven't seen the photos. Maybe he looks like him.
He's a male Lara Croft. And it's very good. That's on IGN
okay,
right
well,
now. So.
Forgive me for giving him more credit than he deserves. Guys.
You can find me on Twitter at @DMC_Ryan. I sell some fun t-shirts. There's a link on my Twitter profile. Not wearing one today because it's really awful weather in San Francisco this month so far.
Yeah, this weekend's going to be nice.
I hope so.
Yeah. I wear a jacket coming in, and then it's hot by lunchtime.
Yeah.
And then it's cold when I leave.
It's truly terrible.
I've got, to the Bay Area.
Yeah.
I've got a weekly Tesla podcast if you like cars that are not powered by gasoline. And what else? Oh, the big one, of course, which hopefully you've seen already today. As of now, my Gears of War 4 beta preview is up. Both in written form and a whole bunch of video clips too, including a proper video preview. So take a look at that on IGN. And as Destin said, if you're fascinated by No Man's Sky, just as we are, I'm working hand in hand with Destin on all that stuff.
Yeah.
So that's going to be rolling out all month long on IGN.
Cool.
For Alana, the Shark, and Destin, my name's Ryan. This is Podcast Unlocked, or was Podcast Unlocked, episode 241. Next week's a palindrome.
Palindrome.
Every 10 weeks. Awesome. Or thereabouts.
I guess it could also be nine. Whatever.
It would be
whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
Every couple months or so. Anyway, we'll see you guys next week.